swimmers and coaches. There is now less than 40 seconds before we clear the pool from this warm-up. Would you please assist us in clearing the pool in a timely fashion to aid us to get this competition started on time? Please, can you clear the pool at 25 past? Give us your assistance in doing so. Thank you. For swimmers and coaches, the warm-up session is now finished. Please assist us in clearing the pool in preparation for the competition start. The warm-up pool is now closed. Thank you.
Hello and welcome to all the spectators that have just joined us here at the British Gas Swimming Championships for 2013. Now, right, I'm sat with two very special people here. Just introduce yourself and say who you are here to watch today.
My name's Jamie from the workshop, which is here for the
Right, and yourself, what's your name?
Edward.
So, Edward, now we have a very good winning prize here from Speedo, who are our official partners. Now, we have a quiz for you. Are you feeling up to this? Yeah, okay, good. So the question is, what city are the World Championships going to be held in this year? A, Rome, B, Barcelona, or C, Paris? What do you reckon it's going to be?
Barcelona.
Guys, so a massive round of applause. That is the correct answer. So you have won yourself a top of the range pair of balls, and I'm sure you're going to be using those loads. Now let's hear from our official partners. Thank you. Championships. It is also the world qualifications for the trials. So the British it is the trials for the World Championships this year later in Barcelona. Now we have seen some class performances already. We've only just had the heats. We saw Jonathan Fox smash the world record in the 100 metres backstroke this morning. Now we're expecting some fast swimming. So what happens when we have fast swimming? We cheer and we support. Now, what is going to happen if we have another world record tonight? We're going to hear some music which sounds a little bit like this. Let's have a quick sneak peek. Okay, so it's a Queen classic. Now, what happens is when we hear that bit of music, we are going to clap, we are going to cheer, we are going to stand up, and we are going to make loads of noise. But to practice and to get ourselves ready for that, we're going to have a little bit of a practice run now. Spectators, are you ready? Okay, maybe not. Let's try again. Spectators.
Hello and welcome to the Fast Lane. We are going to bring you exclusive action from the British Gas Swimming Championships 2013 being held here in Ponds Forge, Sheffield. And this is the one and only chance for our British athletes to qualify for the FINA World Championships taking place not too long away in Barcelona. Now, as you can see behind me, the finals are getting well underway. There's lots of preparations taking place before the finals are about to start imminently. And over the next few days, we're going to be bringing you lots of heats highlights. We're also going to have all sorts of former swimmers and current swimmers and all their opinions and lots of great guests in. So you do not want to miss a thing. Now, alongside me for the next few days is the lovely Ross Davenport, who's highly knowledgeable. He's been competing for Great Britain for the last 10 years. He's a three-time Olympian and a two-time Commonwealth gold medalist, so we could not be in better company. Ross, what's it like being here today?
It's absolutely fantastic. Coming here, seeing the buzz of all the swimmers, getting ready for the finals is absolutely brilliant. Normally I'd be on that side, but retiring last year in October, and now I'll be working with Bob Ballard in the commentary box for the live streaming. So it's brilliant to be this side of the fence, so to speak, but it's also nice to see all the swimmers getting on with their action. And looking forward to the finals tonight.
And this is the first big meet for the athletes off the back of London. Their performances were slightly under par. Maybe, you know, we were a little bit disappointed with their performances. How do you think they're going to be feeling now and the mood they're feeling?
Yeah, obviously London was around about 12 months ago and it didn't go to plan. It's been much publicised that we didn't reach our targets. But now it's all moving on to the road to Rio. This is the first year of a four-year plan. New guys have come in terms of Chris Spice and Bill Furness. So it's under a new regime. The swimmers are full of life now. They want to put London to bed and move on to the next competition, which is the World Championships later on this year.
And what is the mood like in the lead-up to World Championships? This is the trials. This is what it's all about.
The World Championships are massive. At the end of the day, it is the World Championships. It's only second to the Olympic Games. So this is where the rest of the world will put a marker out and put a benchmark out for the rest of the world. New swimmers are going to be coming through, not only in Britain, but the rest of the world. We saw last year 15, 16-year-olds winning Olympic medals. It's going to be no different this year at the World Championships.
And do you feel a little bit of like, oh, I'd love to be in there. I want to be competing. I want to be going for those times.
Yeah, a part of me misses it, especially when it's this hot on poolside. Love to be in there racing. But, you know, having represented my country for the last 10 years, it was the right time to hang up my trunks and move on to this side of the fence. But it is nice to catch up with everyone who used to train with and used to race with. And I'm really excited to see not only the current British squad competing, but also the youngsters coming through. We saw this morning some fantastic talent coming through, and it's going to be very, very exciting times.
And you sort of mentioned the World Championships there, and that is the focus for today. And actually, what we're going to be looking for now is we're going to be speaking to a couple of our selection panels. We're going to be speaking to one selection panel in particular. So let's find out what they think they've got to do to make the selection criteria. I'm joined by Martin Woodruff, who's the National Performance Director of Swim Wales. He's an Olympic silver medalist, and he's got a very important job this week as he is the chairman of the selection panel for the World Championship team. It's great to have you here, Martin. Are you having a great week so far?
Delighted to be here. We've seen some good swimming so far, so yes, it's very good.
And from a selection point of view, what are you guys looking for?
Our key role as selectors is to make sure that the team is selected according to the written selection policy.
And what are the key points within that policy?
The main thing is that we're selecting 30 swimmers. They do have to achieve the qualifying times, but hopefully we will be able to select a full team.
You said it's only going to be 30. Now, that's quite a small number compared to other events. What's the thinking behind that idea?
One of the things that came out of the Olympics debrief was that we needed smaller teams, teams where swimmers will definitely make the finals and then go on from the finals to winning medals.
And there's a lot of pressure then on the swimmers themselves. How are they feeling? What's the mood within the camp?
I'm pretty certain that everyone's going to swim well and respond to the challenges. I'm certain as well that we're going to have more than 30 swimmers do the qualifying times.
That makes your job very difficult though. How do you kind of go through sieving through who deserves to be on the team?
We will prioritise the swimmers and obviously look at all of the different aspects of the selection policy to sort of decide which we think are the best 30 swimmers.
Are we expecting to see the ones that performed well in London to be on that team list?
I would hope so. I would hope that there are some new faces coming through as well.
Wow, it sounds very exciting. Where will we see that team? When will that team list be posted?
The final selection will be on Sunday night. We meet with Chris Spice and Bill Furness on Monday, and the team will be announced on Monday lunchtime.
And we'll be able to find that list on swimming.org on the website, so we will look out for that. So as you can see, Martin's got a very tough job on his hands, as well as all the swimmers here. There's a lot of pressure, but that's the excitement we're going to look forward to this week. So that was Martin Woodruff there, who was the chairman of the selection criteria panel, so he's got a big job ahead of him tonight. But for the moment, we're going to be focusing on this morning's action, and it's day one, and we're going to be taking a look at the heat highlights. So let's see how all the swimmers got on.
The first day of five for the able-bodied competitors started with the heats of the men's 400 freestyle, and with the retirement of David Carey and David Davis, this event has opened up for others to challenge Robbie Rennick. Maybe it'll be European junior bell Matt Johnson or Olympian Ian Lloyd. It was the former who edged out the Welshman in heat one, 3:53.54, a solid heat swim, but Lloyd or Lewis Smith, neither would make it through to the top eight. Heat 2 had several leaders, a real cat and mouse eight lengths here, containing the likes of Dan Fogg, James Guy, Tom Sunter and Robbie Rennick. But it was one of the newer of the City of Sheffield swimmers, Nick Granger, who had a stunning last turn to edge out the more illustrious names in the race and post a 5-second, yes, 5-second personal best of 3:50.24 and to be the fastest qualifier. The last of the 200 butterfly heats contained Olympic finalist Gemma Lowe. She is expected dominated throughout the event. The Swansea University swimmer 2:10.45 means she's got to find another second for qualification. The men's 50 breaststroke is wide open, as the 100 looks to be as well. It's the scrap between Scottish record holder Ross Murdoch and Christopher Steeples that caught the eye. Lane 4 scrapping with lane 5, going stroke for stroke, 27.92. They finish with the same time, Steeples with a new personal best. Fran Housall looked to have a lot left in the tank for one of her best events, the 50 freestyle. The Olympic finalists eased down, but still managed to put in a 25.06, which is very close to qualifying, and she'll surely do that tomorrow night. On to the men's version, and in truth, British swimming is yet to replace Mark Foster in the 53. It's Ben Proctor the man, he might feel he is. The very talented junior from Plymouth had American collegiate swimmer James Disney May in his sights. Not a respect for reputation, though. 22.20 for Ben, a best time for him. In the women's 200 backstroke, Lauren Quigley's had an impressive 2013 so far. Looks like continuing in a similar vein, the Stockport Metro swimmer winning heat 2 in 2:12.69. The last able-bodied event of the morning was the women's 800 metres freestyle. It's been great to see a return to form for Jazz Carlin. 8:24.42 in Leeds in March. She destroyed the field in her heat. In the end, she finished in 8:30.06. A great time, and you feel there's still a lot more to come. And last but certainly not least, to a multi-disability world record, and it came in the 100 backstroke for men. Paralympic gold medalist Jonathan Fox has been in record-breaking form recently. Stopped the clock in this race at 1 minute 9.52, 10.56 points in the S7 category.
So that was all the action from this morning's heats. Lots of things to look forward to this evening. And just before, we want to make sure that you guys are getting involved today. So we are putting up our Twitter feed, and all you have to do is hashtag BGSC13. Send in any of your questions you have for myself, for Ross. But for now, we're going to head straight over to Bob Ballard for the men's multi-classification 100 metres freestyle.
Okay, thank you very much indeed, and good afternoon. Let's start with the 100 freestyle final, and quite a range of different categories here. S8, S9, S10, and S12 are all represented here. So as usual, we'll tell you,
whoever wins it doesn't necessarily win it. That's the whole point. The first person to touch the wall is not always the winner. It will be calculated into points relevant to the category they are in. And I know we do this every time, but Ross, there are still some people who aren't quite sure how somebody could touch the wall first and not win a race.
Yeah, that's right, Bob. But that's why it's so exciting, the disability races, because like you say, somebody could come in 10th place and actually break a world record and win the event. So that's why it does keep you on the edge of your seat, and that's why it's a fantastic event.
So we'll have a look and see how this one is developing. Obviously, we can see races within races. So for example, lane 7, Joseph Craig and Jonathan Fox, who set a new record this morning in the backstroke, could be going for it. But the centre lane, the ones we're watching, 4 and 5, and S10 against an S12. Rob Wellborn. Points, well, there's not much between them on that either. 7:36 for Rob Wellborn, 7:44 for James Clegg, but Joseph Craig, 9:09, is going to take this at the moment, looking through the other scores. Just one to finish, Sasha Kindred, and it's going to be lane number 7. Joseph Craig, who takes it in 9:09 points for his category. So Joseph Craig, who was one of our Paralympic gold medalists back in London last year, comes up with a victory again.
Yeah, that's right. He was on fantastic form last year at the London Para Games, and he's carrying that form now onto this year in 2013 and going into the World Championships in Montreal.
Just seen the top two finishing, Rob Wellborn and James Clegg, 4 and 5, but that's not how it pans out in terms of points. It is Joseph Craig from Jonathan Fox and Sasha Kindred, 9:09 playing 8:35, playing 7:84. Joseph Craig gets the gold and silver going to Jonathan Fox, Sasha Kindred in third place. That was the men's 100 meters freestyle final. Of course, when it comes to Montreal and the World Paralympic swimming in about 4 weeks' time, they will all be swimming in the same category together. It'll be a proper race in terms of knowing exactly straight away who's won it, but obviously because this is tagged on to the end of the able-bodied program, they are all thrown in together. So we're going to hear from the winner. Here's Joseph Craig with Cassie Patton.
I'm on poolside with a very happy Joseph Craig. How was that 100 freestyle then?
Oh yes, the fastest one of the season, so I'm happy with that. I mean, it's 0.1 off me PB, so that sets us up nicely for Canada, where hopefully it'll be all PBs.
You had a great year last year at the Paralympics. What are you aiming for in the summer?
Well, really just to continue on the great summer I had last year in the Paras and at World Championships, do some good times and show off my skills there again, and hopefully win a few medals for GB.
Well, you showed off your skills here today, so a massive round of applause for Joseph Craig.
So that was a top performance by Joseph Craig, though he was a great performer in London, and he's back and he's in great form, and we'll look forward to him over the course of the week, because that's not even his main event. Now, you may have noticed that it was quite a confusing process of working out who was the winner in that particular race, and even myself as an athlete, I do get a little bit confused. So I've put together a bit of a package for you to try and understand the actual process of how the disability athletes win at this particular competition. This week, the disability racing will be run as multi-classification racing. Now, this is a very difficult thing to understand, and even myself as a Paralympic swimmer does struggle to understand the concept. But actually, it can be very easy to understand, and I'm going to try and put that together for you in this particular package. Now, regardless of disability, all the swimmers will be competing in the same final. However, the winner will be decided on the British disability points that they earn, and that is all dependent on how many points and how close they are to the world record time. So that means that the person that touches the wall first with the fastest time isn't necessarily the winner. Actually, it could be the person coming in last, because they may be closer to their world record. The British disability points is what you'll be hearing a lot, and if you see anything near the 1,000 points, it means they are very close to world record pace. Now, people like Eleanor Simmons could be very close to that 1,000 points, because that is her particular personal best, and actually they could be the ones winning. And we know that Ellie will not be the fastest in the pool, but she could be the closest to the world record. British disability points are like FINA points, and it means that that is what is the most important thing to look out for at this particular event. And actually, if you want to know more about disability swimming and you want to understand the classifications a bit more, here's a quick little idea. The S stands for swimming, and the number stands for the level of disability. 1 being the least most disabled, and 10 being the least disabled. And then S11 to S13 is visually impaired, and 14 is learning difficulties. But that's all quite a lot to take in. And the most important thing is that we look for the person with the most British disability points, and then they will be the winner and be top of the medal podium. So hopefully that was very useful for you to take in. We are going to be going straight down to the next final with Bob Ballard for the women's multi-class 100 metres freestyle.
And we'll be looking for the likes of Hannah Russell in lane 4, Amy Maron in 5, and Claire Cashmore in 7. That is pretty much a who's who of female British Paralympic swimming here. Susie Rogers in 0. Chloe Buck in 1, Tully Kearney in 2, Alice Tai in 3, Hannah Russell in 4, Amy Maron 5, Eleni Papadopoulos 6, Claire Cashmore 7, Emma Hollis in 8, and Francesca O'Connor in the S7 category. Now, Amy Maron at the disabled event earlier on this year was an absolute star, and another one of those teenagers who seemed to come from nowhere, Ross.
Yeah, exactly. She's absolutely brilliant. As was Hannah Russell in Leeds in March time. She was fantastic, almost going 1,000 points every time she got into the pool.
Well, let's see how this pans out, because we have S7s, 8s, 9s, 10s and 12s in there. So once again, just attending, I'm sure that those of you who know this get very bored of me saying it, but those who don't, whoever touches first does not necessarily win the race, because the points are attributed to the category they swim in. And the winner of the S12s is going to be, without too much doubt, because she is on her own, Hannah Russell doing the S12. Let's see how many points she can pick up. There are a couple of S10 side by side. Alice Tai in 3 and Tully Kearney in lane number 2. But it's going to be Hannah who will touch first, which will equate to how many points? 877. That's a fair return. So that's going to take some beating. 860 from Amy Maron, so she's not going to quite get it. Best of the moment is Hannah Russell. Anybody up in the 900s? Doesn't look like it. It looks like the winner might be the winner on this occasion. It might be one of those rare occasions in a multi-classification where the person who touches first actually does get the major point. It is. There you are. After what I just said, 877, Hannah Russell. We can actually talk this one in, because she is the winner.
Yeah, it was great that you saw 5-6 metres out. She got her head down, really drove to the wall. A fantastic swim from Hannah Russell, and she won the race, and she won the point score at the overall at the end.
Yeah, one of our stars, definitely, and Amy Maron of Ron for town. Hannah Russell is, what, just 16 years of age. Amy Maron is 14 years of age, not 15 until August. So the 1-2-3 is Hannah Russell, Amy Maron, and Susie Rogers from Otters, who manages to combine working for the British Council with swimming at the same time. Not quite how she does both the things, but she does.
That's a tough, grueling programme, that is, but... You know, we have such a great heritage in Paralympic swimming, and that looks like it's, you know, it's got a long way to go. And the road to Rio is 3 years to go now, and it looks like we're so strong in some events in British Paralympic swimming.
I am here with Hannah Russell. Well done, Hannah. That was a great win there. Very close at the end. How are you feeling?
Yeah, I was really, really pleased after that event. Coming in this morning, doing a 101.99, my aim was to just try and go a bit faster. So I managed to achieve and I was really pleased.
Perfect. So what are your goals and aims for the rest of this season?
I mean, coming here, I've got a few more events. I'd just like to try and come here and try and do as well as I can and try and get as close as I can to my PBs. So.
Wonderful. Well, you'd have a great start to the week and I hope to see you lots more. Let's have a massive round of applause for Hannah Russell.
Great. And I can guarantee that will not be the last time we see Hannah Russell over the course of this meet. These youngsters are really flying through in top colours. Joseph Craig in the first race, then Hannah. And there's so much going on with these particular disability athletes because they've already qualified for World Championships. They qualified a few months ago and they'll be competing in Montreal in August later on this year. So they've got lots to look forward to. And to be honest, this meet isn't really a big deal for them. This is just a bit about swimming through and really putting their training into practice to ensure that they're in the best possible shape ready for Montreal in August. And I've got Ross back with me here in the studio. And we have to say thank you very much to Bob Ballard. I didn't give him the introduction he deserved in the lead up to those particular races. And he will be commentating for us throughout the course of the meet. And he's highly experienced and knowledgeable in this particular field. So we look forward to hearing from him. And he will have Ross by his side the whole time. Now, Ross, you were commentating on those races. Now, what really stuck out to you?
It's great to see Joseph Craig, you know, continuing that form that we saw him in last year in London, coming into 2012. Sometimes it can be a tendency that, you know, once you've reached those great heights, that you are now kind of set back a little bit, but he's flying through. He's got the World Championships coming on later on. And what's great to hear is when he talks about winning medals for Great Britain, it's not necessarily all about the performer, but it's actually doing the nation proud. And that's what came across in that interview. And it's exciting to see him and exciting to listen to him talk about when he's talking about swimming for Great Britain.
Well, he's a great character, and, you know, he won Young Sports Personality of the Year back in 2012, and he's just got such this likeable character about him. Do you think that's going to help him in terms of making his way higher up into the swimming world?
Certainly do. You know, it doesn't matter if you're a nice guy or not when it comes down to winning medals, but certainly his character is really nice. You can tell he's laid back. He's just excited to swim for Britain. He's excited to be here. Like you said earlier, this is not the most important competition in the world for them this year, but he's putting that training into practice and he's ironing out those small little things that he can work on, and hopefully we can see him in Montreal doing bigger and better things.
Because they've already had 32 athletes that have actually been selected for the team, which actually for a disability team is quite small, and that seems to be the case for what they're selecting for the able-bodied team as well. They're only going for 30. Do you think that's going to work in the team's favour, having less people on the squad?
Yeah, I think it will do. Bill Furness is talking about making a more streamlined ship going forward and making it more probably performance orientated. And I think when you're taking a small group of 30 swimmers to a competition, all 30 wanting to get onto the podium. There's a common drive, and as soon as one person gets onto the podium, that really does, you know, filter through to the rest of the team that actually I can do it. I'm part of this team. And, you know, when there's a bigger team, sometimes that can get diluted a little bit. So hopefully we can keep it a tight-knit group of swimmers, both in the able body and the disability swimming, and we can be really successful going on into Rio.
And I think for all you people out there, there's lots to look forward to in terms of, we've got Ellie Simmons coming up this week, and she has also qualified onto that British team. And they've got a lot to look forward to for the rest of the season, because it's just going to be on and on to the next competition. And we're going to be having the medal ceremonies coming up very soon to those particular races. So we'll get to see how proud they are just to be winning those particular medals. And also coming up, we have the likes of the Hine brothers. We always love that battle because it's like the Brownlee brothers. It's our very own version of the Brownlee triathlon version, but this time we have it in the pool. And I think it's going to be a really exciting meet for the rest of us. And you will see taking up part, just behind us is the victory ceremony, so we'll be taking a look at that. But actually, Ross, I want to talk a little bit more about World Champs and what our swimmers have got coming up in terms of how are they going to handle the pressure, because they've only got about 3 or 4 weeks until they actually have to compete in Barcelona. Are they going to be able to handle that pressure?
Yeah, I'm sure they will do. This is the first time we've done the trials so late here in Britain. Normally we tend to do it around March, April time. So doing it towards the end of June is completely new. Only one nation in the world does this, and that's America and the US. And so we all know how successful they are. So hopefully that will rub off and we can actually be really successful. We alluded on it earlier that London probably wasn't our greatest competition. So we're trying to put things right moving forward. We also appreciate that, you know, the Olympics is really all that matters, but each stepping stone along the way is where we look at new blood coming through, that if we don't have the great swimming in the World Championships, we know that we can put it right the next year in the Commonwealth Games or the Europeans, and then moving forward going on to Rio, because this team, this current team of swimmers, both in the able-bodied and disability swimming, is really, really talented, and I think we can really kick on from now going into Rio.
And I think we've got a very exciting 4 years ahead of us, but as you can see, there is the legendary Joseph Craig receiving his gold medal, and he's got so many now. I do wonder, Ross, does this one actually mean much to him? He's gotten a Paralympic gold. He doesn't look too fazed, to be honest.
Yeah, I think any time you get into the pool, you want to win. So, you know, this probably won't be going on to his mantelpiece as next to his Olympic or Paralympic gold medal, but certainly this will be a very proud moment for him. You know, he doesn't want to get into the pool and lose, so he wants to keep his mantle going. He wants to keep that stature that he is one of the best Paralympic swimmers around, and he certainly did that today.
And also alongside him was Jonathan Fox, who is a very tough competitor for him. And they've always been very closely competitive. And I actually spoke to John when he was competing in London, because he was actually beaten by Joseph Craig. And, you know, I don't think there's too many kind words between them. And I'm sure it's like that on your British team. Is there any sort of close rivalries that people maybe aren't best buddies, even though they race against each other?
Yeah, well, that's the case, you know. Just because you're on the team together doesn't mean that you're best friends. You know, I was fortunate through my swimming career, especially in the relays, that when those four lads came together, we were great friends. And that does, you know, get the best out of you if you know that you are competing with your friends and competing against each other. But friendly rivalry or just rivalry on its own, it can only bring out the best in swimmers, because if there's somebody you don't necessarily like, you want to beat them, and especially if you're close friends, you definitely want to beat them. So it works both ways.
Did you have anyone that you didn't like talking to on the team that you're a bit like, you know what, you're not my cup of tea?
To be honest, I'm quite an easygoing guy, so you know, I think I got on with most people. But you know, there are those rifts in camps. When you're taking it, we had a squad last year about 45 swimmers.
Yeah.
You can't expect everybody to get on. And normally, what happens, they just won't mingle and just kind of move to one side. And there are certainly no fisticuffs or anything like that. No, as a team, we were very, very close last year, and that's why it was so hard to take. The disappointments of last year did hit us hard.
And you know, you remind me of a particular guy who's just in the third medal position there, Sasha Kindred, because he's a very humble guy. He's been on the team for many years, competed in a number of Paralympic Games. He's got the bronze there, an event that he never really makes an appearance in, so it's great to see that. And how important is it to have the older members on the team?
It's crucial, in my opinion. Somebody that's been there and done it a couple of times. You know, obviously, in London, we had Rebecca Addington, who 4 years previous had won two gold medals. Somebody that you can just relate to and just say, how did you cope with the pressure? And that's great to have that on the team.
And as you can see now, we have the medal ceremony for the women's multi-classification 100 metres freestyle. And it's quite a young-looking podium. Again, we've got young Hannah Russell there from Kelly College. And she's not even really a 100 metres freestyler. She'll be looking to focus on the 100 backstroke, the 100 butterfly, which she medalled in London earlier in 2012. And we've got young little Amy Marin there, who is an absolute breakthrough swimmer in this coming year. She actually came fourth in London, and I think that was a great spur on for her to really get stuck in and really make a difference to 2013, and then she's going to go to World Championships and just make a real scene. And for Ross, for a youngster taking on that sort of job, it almost seems impossible.
Yeah, but youngsters, we all say it, you know, they don't feel the pressure, and they can get in. And when you've got certain likes, when you talk about Sasha Kindred on the team, you know, they want to reach those highs that he's reached. So it doesn't matter if you're male, female, or 14 or 34, you want to get there and you want to get to the top. So it's great to see that the youngsters are coming through, because it can only bode well for the next 3 years.
And after this now, we're going to be moving on to the able-bodied finals. We've got lots coming up. We've got 50s, we've got 400s. You know, it's a real appetite for anyone who enjoys swimming. Which event are you most looking forward to coming up tonight?
Well, there's a host of events that's going to be great tonight. But for me, I think the 400 metres freestyle. You've obviously got Robbie Rennick, who's been to two Olympic Games before, being chased down by a host of young swimmers, which is going to be fantastic, because he needs to be pushed. He's had his own way for the last couple of years, so it'd be great to see how close these youngsters can get to him, if not beating him. I think, especially the year after London, there'll be a few upsets.
And in terms of new ones coming through, have we got anyone we need to look out for?
We mentioned it in Leeds earlier on in this year, but James Guy is a fantastic talent. The 200, the 400 metres freestyle, he also does the medley as well. He is an incredible talent. He's down in Millfield, and he's one to watch for.
And I think we've got coming up now, we have the semi-finals for the 50 metres breaststroke and the 50 metres freestyle. So we're going to head over to Bob Ballard, who is going to be doing the semi-finals for us for this particular race.
Okay, thank you. So we run through the 1-8 for you before they come on to pool deck. Levi Lucas will represent Hatfield SC. Did the qualifying time this morning of 23.43. Owen Morgan goes in 2-4 Woking. In 3 will be Carl Morgan of Nova Centurion. And then the return of Adam Brown from Hatfield Swimming Club. Spends most of his time, of course, these days in America, but he goes in lane number 4, coming back and was with Hatfield before he went back over to the States. Andrew Weatherett of Loughborough is in lane 5. Andrew Bushell in lane 6, also for Loughborough University. Season's best of 23.03, went slightly slower than that in the heats this morning, 23.12. Kieran McGuckin of Edinburgh University going in lane number 7. And in lane number 8 from Scarborough Swimming Club. I don't mention Scarborough Swimming Club very often, so we will do on this occasion. 23.50 Ross Clegg. Maybe a chance to give a mention to Filey Swimming Club, which sadly closed down earlier on this year. Filey just up the coast from Scarborough. It's a couple of miles away. Right, so the first semi-final, remember, top 8 go through, top 8 times go through to the final of the 50 freestyle. It's a splash and dash. And will one of our Olympians, Adam Brown, come out on top? He should do. He is the fastest in this field. Remember, they're looking for just above 22 seconds for qualifying. They can't do it in the semis, Ross, but he can at least post a good time here.
Yeah, that's right. Adam Brown's had a fantastic start. So is Owen Morgan, but Owen Morgan is now tailing off, and Adam Brown is about a metre ahead.
Yeah, it's a good swim from Adam Brown. How good is it where the clock is concerned? That's the important thing, though. And 22.17 is a couple of tenths quicker than he went this morning. Second place going to Andrew Weatherett in 22.64. So that's a new personal best for him. And third to Carl Morgan. So Adam Brown getting in that kind of shape. Remember, they're going to get down to just above 22. I think it's 22.06 to get a qualifying time. So he's getting there, not quite there yet.
No, Adam Brown's best time from 2011 was 22.08. So he's only just outside of that. That's a fantastic swim for him. And it, to be honest with you, it looked like he was easing down towards the finish. He knew he was going to get qualified for the final. That's a fantastic swim.
Great swim indeed from Adam Brown. Looked very controlled all the way through. And of course, he's spending most of his time in America these days. Hasn't really had a great chance to swim since he came back. So he's probably a little bit rusty and just trying to blow those cobwebs away today.
Certainly, and he certainly blew them away on that race because as soon as the gun went, he was out there in the lead. Owen Morgan had a fantastic start. I used to race Owen Morgan when I was 15, and he's still going and still producing some quality times. So it's interesting to see if he'll make the final in fifth place.
Big question now for me is, Ross, you won't have seen the heat this morning, Ben Proud of Plymouth Neander. And let's have a look at the 1-8 for this race. There they are, Jack Thorpe, Grant Turner, of course, who you know very well from Loughborough, Adam, Alex Gunn in 3. But Ben Proud, fastest qualifier, 22.20. And, of course, James Disney May, another American-based Brit.
Ben Proud is only 18, 19 years of age. He's a fantastic talent, and he really is coming along very, very quickly. He's obviously down in Plymouth, where Ruta was from, an Olympic champion in 100 metres breaststroke. So he's got a great training group around him, and I think he's going to do big things this year.
So Ben Proud, just to tell you again, 22.20 this morning, personal best time from him. And talking to his coach earlier, John Rudd, reckons that his finish wasn't all that good this morning, that he can improve. He expects him to improve. And of course, he gets down to 22 dead. He actually gets the qualifying time for the World Championships in Barcelona. But a lot of buts here. He wants to see him go 15 meters underwater at the start. He thinks he does it on fly. he thinks he can do it on freestyle. We'll keep an eye on that. Ross off the start. Watch out for, in the middle of the picture, Ben Proud. How far has he gone?
He's probably gone about 12 metres, so he's got another 3 metres that he can go on further towards his, what his coach is saying, but he's out there in the lead now. He's looking extremely smooth, surfing that water, and he is about a metre ahead going into the last 10 metres.
Well, like Adam Brown in the previous semi-final, he is dominating this race, and the time, 22.01. He's got the time for the World Championships. He needs to do it again, though, in the final tomorrow night. Semi-finals will not count, but that is a huge, massive PB today. He's taken two big chunks, 22.20 this morning, 22.01 tonight.
I'm sticking my neck on the line here, Bob, and saying he is going to break the British record later on this evening, which I believe is 21.96. So he's down towards that finish, as you just saw. He has got a lot more in the tank.
Of course, I'm saying tonight, the final is tonight, of course, because we've condensed an eight-day program into five. So we will see him again later. He has got that qualifying time. Let's have a look at the result, because we were concentrating on everybody else and ignoring Grant Turner in second then. James Disney May in third. But look at the gap in a 50, nearly three-quarters of a second between first and second there, Ross.
That's huge. You know, talking about 1.5 metres. That's such a long way in a 50-metre race, and he blew them apart. I was talking to Grant Turner earlier, and he's the one. He said Ben Proud is the one to beat, and he certainly is on that performance.
Well, that is a really big step, and John Rudd will be absolutely delighted with that. He's a really nice guy. I met Ben earlier today for the first time. Very humble, and no side to him, absolutely none whatsoever. And he said, yeah, I think he can go a bit quicker. Well, he's gone nearly 0.2 seconds quicker tonight, and that's huge in 50 freestyle terms.
It is, and I think he can go another 0.2 quicker.
Well, we'll see in the final later on tonight in the 50 freestyle. Yeah, well, what can he do later on? And you know, that's the kind of age where you want to see that kind of improvement. But the 53, and I mentioned when we saw the videotape earlier, that apart from Mark Foster in the 53, so we've not produced anybody of that standard for a long, long time.
No, we haven't. We always tend to have 100 metres swimmers that are stepping down to the 50. We've never really produced an out-and-out 50 swimmer like Mark Foster was. He never ventured anything over 55 metres, so he was a pure sprinter. One length, that was his event. But, you know, an important thing to remember is when you're in the semi-final, you are more relaxed, and you can swim a lot faster when you're relaxed. As soon as you start to tense up, you do go a lot slower. So he would have been relaxed because he knew he was fastest qualifying, knew he was going to make the final. So hopefully if he can stay relaxed later on in the final, we can see some big things.
Here's the 1-8 for the next race, which is the women's 50 metres freestyle. And this is semi-final number one. And featuring in this one will be the second fastest Brit from Loughborough, Amy Smith, going in lane four. Give you the full 1-8, so we didn't keep it on the screen for very long. Isabel Hindley in one for Chelsea Westminster. Ellen Thomas of Guildford City in two. Hannah Keane in three for Hastings. On to four, there's Amy Smith. Five is Jessica Lloyd of City of Manchester. Six, Harriet Cooper. Seven is Sean Harkin of Plymouth. Eight, Fiona Hardle of Poole. Now again, we can probably make a little bit of a prognostication on this one and tell you that Amy Smith, second fastest in Britain, should be the fastest in this race.
Yeah, that's right, should be. But I'm interested to see how Harriet Cooper does in lane six. She's only 16 years of age, but from the city of Leicester, she's got great potential moving on forward. But this is Amy Smith in lane four leading out this field.
Yeah, Harriet Cooper doesn't actually turn 16 until next month, but this is all about Amy Smith. And she should go quicker than she did this morning. And Amy Smith does stop the clock at 25.20, 0.3 of a second quicker, faster she's been this season. Second place going to Jess Lloyd of City of Manchester Aquatics, and third to Hannah Keane. This is how Amy finished.
You see it, she's got her head down. Swimmers will tend to breathe once, if not zero times, on a 50 metre freestyle. So she's had her head down going into the finish, really getting onto her side and driving to that wall. This is a transitional year for Amy. She's got a new coach this year, and it'll be interesting to see how she gets on. Now she's into the final tonight. It'll be a close race between her and Fran Housel.
Here come the classified computed results for you. Amy Smith, 25.20. Jess Lloyd in second. Hannah Keane. And look at those youngsters. Well, Harriet Cooper, 26 dead for the City of Leicester swimmer. And that is just outside of personal best. Personal best she set in the heats this morning.
Coming fourth in that heat, she might be able to make the final, top eight, obviously, into the final later on at the end of the programme tonight.
We will find that. Four is Fran Housel of Loughborough. Five is Emma Wilkins of Loughborough. Rebecca Guy of City of Manchester Aquatics going in lane six. Eloise Barber in seven and Jess Jackson from Hatfield in eight. I think we might, you might have to talk into the back of that one, Ross.
Francesca Housel is Britain's number one this year, and for probably the last 5 or 6 years in the 100 and 50 metres freestyle. Sophie Smith is an incredible all-rounder swimmer, so it'd be interesting to see how she goes in lane three.
Well, let's find out as we see the second semi-final, the British record holder going in lane four. That is Fran Housel. Best time this year of 24.44. She'll be looking to go a bit quicker. The time that she did this morning, 25.06, is a qualifying time for the world champs, but she's not going to rest on laurels. And the pink cap of Fran Housel is very, very prominent in this race. She's having a bit of a scrap with Emma Wilkins. Well, I say a scrap, but it's all about Housel now starting to pull away. Not pulling away massively, but she's still a body length clear of Emma Wilkins in lane five. This looks to be a very comfortable, in fact, easing up qualification for Fran Housel. 24.84 is her time, so she's gone a couple of tenths quicker than she did this morning.
That looked incredibly easy for Fran Housel. We spoke about earlier that swimmers probably tend to breathe either zero or one time, and she actually breathed twice. So there's plenty more in the tank for Fran. And there you can see her having a good old chat away with Emma Wilkins, teammate at Loughborough University. Here comes the finish, head down, bang, straight into the wall. Excellent.
So Fran Housel, nice big smile, nice pink cap, and it is Housel, Smith, Wilkins, Sophie Smith, Jess Lloyd, Hannah Keane, Rebecca Guy, and Harriet Cooper, who are the top eight who will progress to the final later on in the session. That's your top eight. Housel, the two Smiths, Wilkins, Lloyd, Keane are the main ones going forward to the final later on today. What's happening now?
And more semi-final action coming your way. Now we turn our attention to the breaststroke. This is the men's 50 meter breaststroke semi-final, number one. In lane one, representing University of Bath.
On to the 50 breaststroke semi-final number one. And here is the lineup. Luke Spain of Bath in one, Jamie Graham of Glasgow in two, Ewan Inglis of Edinburgh in three, Ross Murdoch, who is the Scottish record holder, going in lane number four, the 100 British record holder, Daniel Slawinski in five, Mark Conroy, six of Plymouth, seven, Mark Campbell of Aberdeen, and eight is Lawrence Palmer of Team Luton.
Daniel Slawinski pulled out of the Olympics last year through injury. This is his first major competition since then, or since really the trials from last year. So he's also moved club as well. He's now at Stirling ITC. So he'd be an interesting one to keep an eye out for.
So that's how things are looking here. Ross Murdoch has had a great year. He's done personal bests in the 50, 100 and 200. Ross Murdoch has had an absolutely sensational year for Stirling ITC, and the University of Stirling, as they're now called. He's going lane four, Dan Slawinski of Stirling, his teammate in lane five. 27.92, winning time for Ross Murdoch this morning. So let's see what kind of start. Ross, let's have a look at your namesake stum off the start.
Daniel Slowinski had a very, very good start. He is actually, with 15 metres to go, just edging out in front ahead of Ross Murdoch, but it's tight for third and fourth between lanes two and three.
Let's see how the touch goes there. They're absolutely together, lanes four and five. It's going to be Murdoch and Slowinski, and it's separated by 0.04 of a second in the end. It is lane five that gets it. Dan Slowinski gets the touch just 0.04 of a second ahead of Ross Murdoch with Ewan Inglis of Edinburgh. In fact, it's a 1-2-3-4 for Scotland, although Dan is an English swimmer. It is Stirling, Edinburgh, Glasgow.
Both those swimmers inside the qualifying time for the World Championships next month. Obviously, they're not automatically qualified. They have to do it in the final, and the team will also be selected on Monday. That will be confirmed on Monday morning.
Yeah, we'll find out whether they've done it, but of course they've got to do it in the final as well a little later on. But it looks like they're the most likely people to achieve that. 27.76 for Dan Slowinski. He's not doing the 100 here, so this is one and only event. Ross Murdoch in second and Ewan Inglis of Edinburgh in third place for them, with Jamie Graham in fourth for Glasgow. On to semi-final number two. More Stirling swimmers in this one, or one in particular. Joseph Wellstead goes in two. Douglas Scott, though, also of Stirling, goes in lane number one. Mark Tully of East Lothian. There's your full 1-2-8. You see a couple of Stirling swimmers right at the top. Tully, Christopher Steeples, who was equal joint fastest this morning, personal best for him in lane four. Adam Peaty, who is trained, who you know a bit about because you've done a bit of training with him, haven't you, Ross?
Yeah, that's right. Adam Peaty from my old swimming club, City of Derby. I did a bit of coaching at Derby as well the last couple of months. He is a great talent. I know Mel Marshall, who's an Olympian, speaks very, very highly of him.
There's the man, Adam Peaty of City of Derby. Sixth will be Craig Benson, of course, who had a great Olympics with the heat and the semi-final in the 100. No 50s in the Olympics, of course, but there are at the Worlds. So, this is not quite an all-Scottish affair here because there will be Manchester and Derby involved, and it's pretty much an even break there, Ross.
Chris Steeples looks like he had the best start to me, but it is in lane three. Mark Tully is coming through very, very strong, as is Adam Peaty in lane five.
Mark Tully's having a really good swim, but they're coming right back to him. Adam Peaty's having a storming finish here, and he's coming right back over the shoulder of Mark Tully. And Peaty might get this, and does get it, does Adam Peaty. 27.81, that's a new personal best for Adam Peaty. He set a new personal best this morning in the heat. He's bettered it again in the semi-finals. Second place going to Mark Tully, and Christopher Steeples, 28.19, a little bit slower than he went this morning.
The top three from both those semi-finals are separated by 0.05 of a second, so the final later will be all down to who can get in that swim down pool, get the recovery shaken, and who can really can recover in the best possible way.
Here come the classified 1-2-8s, Adam Peaty, Mark Tully and Christopher Steeples, and I could tell you Slowinski, Murdoch, Peaty, Tully are the main ones through to the final later on this evening. Some of the 50s are all in final form later on. We've seen the semi-finals here, and they will have a little chance to just go and have a swim down, get themselves refreshed, and they'll be back for more to try and qualify for the World Championships later on in the final of the 50 freestyle for men and women, and the 50 breaststroke for women and men. That's the action from poolside in the sweaty conditions up in the roof. Kate, how are you doing?
Thanks, Bob. You're not wrong. It is baking up here with all the lights on. But, you know, it just adds to the atmosphere. If you're not hot and you're not ready and you're not warmed up, then we're not going to see fast swims. And I think those 50s, we love the 50s, splash and dash. And it's easy for you, Bob, because it's just a quick race. You're done and you're on to the next one. And if we look over to our Twitter feed now, just remember you can tweet us at BGSC13. And we will read out any more comments and questions that you have for the team. And actually, very appropriately, we have Daniel Stevens, who wished the Loughborough swimming team good luck. And actually, in those 50s, we saw the likes of Fran Housel, Amy Smith. We have the likes of Sophie Smith, Emma Wilkins, all from Loughborough Swimming. So I think they can thank Mr. Daniel Stevens for wishing them good luck, because it clearly had an impact. Also, Wokings from the club said well done to Hannah Russell for her gold medal in the 100 metres multi-classification freestyle race. So great to have your feedback in. Keep it coming to us. But now we're going to head back to Bob Ballard and Ross for our final of the 400 metres freestyle.
From Melfield School, he's James Guy.
Right, on we go to the final, first of the evening for us, of the men's 400 metres freestyle. And this should be a very, very interesting race, probably the race of the night, I think, because there are so many possibles about winning this. Let's run through the lineup for you. Here it is. Greg Hamilton in one, Tom Sunter from Sheffield. There's a lot of Sheffield in here, as you'll see. Rob Brennick in three for Glasgow. Nick Granger, fastest qualifier, 5 second personal best this morning in four. Dan Fogg, James Guy, Stephen Milne, Matt Johnson in eight. Pick me a winner, Ross Davenport.
I think the winner's going to come from lane three, Robbie Rennick. But there's three guys for me that are in close contention for the second spot, and I think their biggest issue is going to be whether they can get that qualification time going into the World Championships.
Well, let's find out, shall we? As they got to go to the blocks. Well, we saw a lot of very, very good swims this morning. A lot of personal bests, a lot of great improvements. Robbie Rennick just keeping his powder dry, I think. Seemed to have a lot in reserve when it came to the end of the race. First final on day one is the men's 400 metres freestyle. The main protagonist should be Rennick. Granger, we don't really know what he could do yet. Dan Fogg and James Guy. It's a pretty star-studded lineup there.
And you can see Robbie's quality shining through right from the word go. He popped up around about a meter ahead. I'd just be wary if I was James Guy being next to Daniel Fogg. Daniel Fogg is the British champion at 1500 and the 10K, so he tend to go out slowly, whereas James Guy should really use his strength and go out as fast as he can. If James Guy stays with Daniel Fogg, I think he might have a bit too much to do in the final 200 metres.
Dan Fogg did set a new personal best in the heats this morning of 350.52, but early stages, Robbie Rennick enjoying a bit of clear water, but Nick Granger's going with him. And at the first 100, they're going to go into the wall pretty much together. Robbie Rennick from Nick Granger, Tom Sunter in third. Danny Fogg will come strong at the back end of the race, and keep an eye out for Matt Johnson on the far side in lane eight.
I think we're witnessing here, Bob, the future of British swimming. We spoke about it in Leeds a couple of months ago with James Guy being the one to watch. Also, Nick Granger, look at him. He's not scared of Robbie Rennick. He makes the Olympic final last year. But Nick Granger's taken this race to Robbie all the way down that first 150 metres.
350 this morning. Can he get down to the regions of a 348, which he'll need to get into for World Championship contention? Well, he's not letting Robbie Rennick go. And nor is Matt Johnson on the far side. Matt Johnson going to European Juniors next week. He'll be doing this event at the European Juniors. But he has obviously not got Robbie Rennick in his sights. He's on the far side. Rennick has about a body length advantage at the halfway stage. And second, Nick Granger. Matt Johnson's in the mix. So too now is Dan Fogg, who's moving up into third place.
That time for Daniel Fogg, 152.89 at the halfway mark, is pretty much right on Daniel Fogg's PB, so he's going to have a storm in the last 200 metres. Robbie's taking this out incredibly quick, turning in 151.0. That is a, you know, that will be making semi-finals in the individual 200, so he's really taking this event to all the youngsters. He's trying to break them early on, and now he is moving, what, 3 or 4 metres ahead with only 3 lengths to go.
Would seem to have this in the bag, but there are two or three people who may have other ideas. But Robbie Rennick looking amazingly smooth and controlled and has this race totally under control. He was keeping his powder very much dry this morning, because that gap is getting bigger and bigger between Robbie Rennick, Nick Granger, Dan Fogg and Matt Johnson on the far side. It's going to be a good old scrap for second place here, but I think first place looks to be secured with 100 metres to go. Robbie Rennick has a lead of what? Nearly 3 seconds over Dan Fogg, who's moved up into second.
That's right, Dan. I said Dan Fogg will have a storm in the last 200 metres, and he certainly is doing. Robbie's gone through his legs. He's really kicking over this last 75 metres. The British record mark of 3:45 could be under threat here. It's Dave Davis's record from Rome 2009, but Daniel Fogg is also powering down with only 1 length to go.
arguably the best 400 freestyle race we've ever seen in this country going on right now. They're all really having a crack. Robbie Rennick, though, is in a race of his own and has got lots of room over everybody else, but everybody else is starting to come back for second place.
Certainly Daniel Fogg and James Guy are closing in on Robbie. Robbie looks like he's almost a spent force. He really broke the field over the first 300 metres and it's coming closer down, 6 metres to go.
Robbie Rennick's going to take it, but not by a huge margin in the end. 3:47.02, that's world championship qualifying time for Robbie Rennick and for Dan Fogg as well. Now, here's a dilemma. Dan Fogg has already qualified for the open water, who we did in the 1500 later in the week. Is the 400 really on his radar? I don't know. Stephen Milne, Perth City, was in the mix as well. Third place going to James Guy. Fourth to Matt Johnson and Nick Granger this morning. Couldn't go as quick tonight as he did this morning, 3:51.26.
You saw that Robbie broke the field. He really went out there and just he did what he had to do, because he couldn't get into a race with these guys. They are fit individuals, especially Dan Fogg, who competes over the 10K. But that is a huge, huge PB for Daniel Fogg. Probably knocked about 5 or 6 seconds off his PB through the start, from the start of the day. But quality swim from Robbie. He can go quicker, but that is an excellent result from Dan Fogg.
Look at that, 3:47.02 for Robbie Rennick. And just outside the personal best, James Guy in third and Matt Johnson in fourth.
James Guy also got the qualification time, but unfortunately he's been locked out because he's the third Brit.
Well, that's strength and depth for you, isn't it? 1, 2, 3, all getting the qualifying time. Brilliant stuff. And 4 under 3:50 as well. Robbie Rennick, Dan Fogg, James Guy, Matt Johnson. And Dan Fogg, before today, had never gone sub 3:50. Well, he has done now. Absolutely amazing stuff. Very impressive, very impressive. So that's, it definitely was the best 400 freestyle we've seen in this country in terms of competition. Fogg in second, James Guy in third, and Matt Johnson in fourth place. Well, I'm sure some words of wisdom that we're going to hear from our Olympian, Robbie Rennick. What a race from him, and they'll talk about it to Cassie Patton right now.
So I'm here with Robbie Rennick, the winner of the men's 400 metres freestyle. Just letting him get his breath back. How was that, Robbie?
That was very tough, especially the last 100 metres. I feel like my legs and everything just fell apart. So the world champs, hopefully I'll be a little bit faster there.
Now, you've been doing a lot of racing recently. You were racing last week in Scotland. How is it doing these back-to-back races?
Yeah, it's great for race practice and... really, the Scottish last week was a bit of a warm-up for this competition, so I'm really looking forward to the rest of the week. I've got quite a busy schedule.
Now, you're underneath that qualifying time, so fingers crossed you'll be selected, but a massive well done on being the British champion for 2013.
So that was the 400 metre freestyle, and it was full of action. And I think, Ross, you definitely enjoyed that, didn't you? But just before we come to you, there was some Twitter action. Lots of support for the Sheffield swimmers, in particular probably Nicholas Granger there. But unfortunately, he did just miss out because the old boys came in and they took over. And you being 29, you can probably say you are a little bit older, so you don't feel so bad about it. But you must be pleased for those guys.
Yeah, obviously. You've been on a team with Robbie for many, many years. And I think his experience showed that he broke the field early on, but he had to. You know, there's some quality youngsters coming through. And he had to do what he had to do, and it, you know, it shone through it towards the end. And really, really pleased and really, really you know, surprised with Daniel Fogg. Knocked over 6 seconds off his PB just in today.
Because he's an open water swimmer, so this isn't really almost short, too short for him. This is a sprint for him.
It certainly is a sprint. You know, he has a black line to follow in the 400 metres, where in the 10K he has fish and reeds to follow. So it's a great swim for him. Just watch out for him on that 1500, because he's obviously swimming very, very well.
And I suppose that looks great for the British team. Three guys doing the qualification time, two of them can only make it. It can only look good for the British team.
Yeah, and like you said earlier, Nick Granger just probably going a little bit slower, but probably the occasion got the better of him. He had to swim a quality time to make it that final this morning. So he's probably a little bit fatigued, but he's only a young lad, so he'll get stronger and stronger. And we're looking for Rio, and there's four guys there that are producing quality times.
Absolutely, and the action doesn't stop there. We're going to hand back to Bob Ballard now for the women's 200 metres butterfly.
Seven going in this one, and there's your 1 to 7. Stephanie Blake Burn of Billingham were one, Isabel Grant, Tilly Gray, Sophie Allen, Georgia Barton, Fiona Donnelly, and Charlotte Bryant, the 1-7. Sophie Allen set the best time this morning, season's best for her of 2:11.54. Georgia Barton, the City of Manchester Aquatics, also did pretty well. In fact, she did a decent time for the morning, certainly enough to get her through. And Tilly Gray is one of the established swimmers from Loughborough going in lane three. Expect Sophie Allen of Bath ITC to be there or thereabouts. She's done a lot over the last couple of years at different events, and Sophie Allen certainly will be thinking that she's in the mix for the final, and certainly a person who possibly could contend against Gemma Lowe.
Yep, Sophie Allen in lane one, qualified for the Olympic team last year in the 200 metre medley, so trying this out, this event out, probably is going to be a warm-up swim, or probably her focus has changed this year to the butterfly event.
Coming up to the end of the first 100, and it is Sophie Allen with her best time, a qualifying time this morning, and see whether she can get to the wall before Tilly Gray does. They're going to go pretty much together, and they go absolutely identically according to the scoreboard. 102.53 is the time at the halfway stage, and this, as any butterfly swimmer will tell you, Stephen Parry's told me on many occasions, this is where it starts to hurt.
Yeah, that's right, 75 metres to go. This is where the lungs are absolutely burning, the shoulders are killing, and the thighs just wanting you to get to the end of the pool. But Tilly Gray is a specialist at 200 metres butterfly. Obviously, Sophie Allen has that background of racing over 200 metres as she raced at the Olympic Games at 200 medley. And it is Sophie Allen that's still out ahead in lane four, but closely challenged by lane three, Tilly Gray.
Let's see how this one shapes up in the last 25 metres. Looks like the white cap of Sophie Allen from Bath ATC has probably just about got this. So Tilly Gray, who seemed to be maybe accepting second place for a while, is now trying to come right back onto her shoulder. But Sophie Allen has enough in the tank to take this all the way to the wall. Tilly Gray is keeping a very close company, but it will be that 1-2. Sophie Allen will touch now, followed by Tilly Gray in second place. And third is Georgia Barton, 2:12.86, just outside her personal best time. And fourth going to Fiona Donnelly of Nova Centauri. Remember, top eight times go through to the final.
Yep, very, very strong swim from Sophie Allen. 2:10.46, that will easily get her into the final, as will Tilly Gray's 2:10.83. So those two will go head-to-head tomorrow night, along with the winner and the second place and third place of the next semi-final.
Just confirmation of that time, as we see Sophie Allen get to the side and go and get ready for her swim down. We'll need that in the end by about 0.4 of a second. Georgia Barton in third place, and Fiona Donnelly of Nova Centauri in fourth. Isabel Grant of Sheffield in fifth.
Well, let's see who joins them in that final.
Next semi-final of the 200 metres butterfly.
In lane one, representing Blackpool Aquatics, Shorter Austin.
Here's the 1-8 for the second semi-final of the women's 200 metres butterfly. Chantel Austin, Libby Mitchell, Alice Thomas, Gemma Lowe, Elena Sheridan, Fern Davis, Brianna Close, and Anna Cheeseborough are your 1-8. So this should all be about our Olympic finalists, Gemma Lowe in lane four. You can give us a bit of an insight, being part of that Olympic team. What's Gemma like?
Yeah, lovely girl. She's been to the last two Olympic Games. She was extremely close to getting the medal in 2011 at the World Championships. She was our main performer in the 2012 Olympic Games last year in the 200 metres fly. Obviously, Ellen Gandy's now moved on to swim for and compete for Australia. So she is now our number one 200 metres butterfly lady.
Let's see what she does here. Up against Eleanor Sheridan, who's improving in leaps and bounds, the 18-year-old from Romford Town, she showed in Leeds earlier on this year. 16-year-old in Chantel Austin in lane one, and Brianna Close of City of Manchester Aquatics is 16 as well. All having a crack at the 200 butterfly. I mentioned earlier on that all Gemma has to do is improve by about a second. And I think, well, she does the time in the semi-final. Of course, she can't carry it through to the final, but I think a second's in her range. And she did look, from the heat swim this morning, in a very comfortable position.
Yeah, her PB is way under that qualification time. But she'll be wanting to get a good solid swim under her belt, qualify for one of the fastest lanes tomorrow for the final, so she can see what's going on, what's around. And as it looks like now, she's already 2 or 3 metres ahead. It's going to be a very, very strong race for her.
Should be Gemma against the clock and everybody else trying to get their best personal times. This morning Gemma did 2:10.45. Well, I think 2:10.45 is going to be a lot less tonight. I mean, she's not got to halfway yet. And there was a time, certainly we'll remember from Beijing, as you will, Ross, where she just went hell for leather in the 200 and died badly over the last 50. Now she swims it in a more sensible way now. She paces the race better and she's not hanging on for dear life at the end.
No, that's right. She really did go out for it in Beijing, but she's still only a young girl. So if you imagine 5 years ago, she was very, very excited to be a part of the Olympic team, to be racing in front of 17,000 people. And I think the occasion just got too much for her, and she just went for it. And you can't argue against a gut and determination. She really did go for it, but she just probably went a little bit too fast down the first three lengths and really suffered the last length. But at the minute, it doesn't look like that's going to be history repeating itself as she comes up. Coming underwater to about 10 metres, and she now has about a 2 or 3 metre advantage, if not more, over the rest of the field.
At the turn, she had about a 2 second advantage, and that may be even bigger by the time she finishes. It's a really hard race, and maybe she is starting to struggle a little bit as we're watching closing in lane 5 and the Sheridan. This morning there was about a 2 second disparity between them, a bit more than 2 seconds, but that is a good time, very good time. That will be a World Championship qualifying time if she does it in the final. 2:08.79 is good from Gemma Lowe, good two from Eleanor Sheridan, 2:10.39, and third place to Alice Thomas of Swansea. So the Swansea teammates in 1 and 3 there, but happy Gemma Lowe.
Just saw a caption there on the screen. She doesn't really look too out of breath. And you know, if you ever talk to Stephen Parry about 200 metres butterfly, he tells you it doesn't matter how fast or how slow you swim a 200 metres fly, it hurts like anything. And that would have hurt her, but she looks extremely comfortable. And I imagine there's a lot more in the final tomorrow night.
I think there is. You know, it gives her another 24 hours to recover, of course, for the final on Wednesday. Are we Wednesday? Thursday, yes, tomorrow night. Second day of competition. Gemma Lowe, 2:08.79, winning that very comfortably from Eleanor Sheridan, Alice Thomas and Libby Mitchell. So 1, 3 and 4 for Swansea University there. And Chantel Austin of Blackpool finishing in fifth place. As we move on to the men's 200 metres butterfly. Now, this was a curious event this morning because there were only 17 entered for it in the end, so only one missed out. So they've separated them out to an 8 and a 7. So somebody else has dropped out now, so we've only got 15 competitors. But I was interested to see another one of your teammates from last year, Michael Rock. Now, Rocky is now doing his law degree, he's moved to City of Liverpool. The impression I got is that swimming wasn't that important to him, but he certainly went out like a rocket this morning.
Yeah, I think that's probably what a lot of people thought. You know, he had a hit in funding as well, so he's had that to deal with. He's doing his law degree, he's moved back to City of Liverpool. Many people thought that might be a backward step for him, but as this morning showed, it certainly wasn't. 1:57.1 is a quality time. He is going to be one of the ones to beat. But Joe Roebuck in lane 3, he's also moved club and moved coach. He used to be trained in Loughborough University, and now he's swimming down at Bath University with Dave McNulty and the likes of Michael Jameson.
Let's have a look at the 1 to 7 in this race. In fact, we can't do that, so I'll give it to you verbally. Adam Fall in 1. We're looking for lane number 3. Joe Roebuck actually is the man we need to keep an eye on here. He's playing possum a little bit this morning. And there is Joe Roebuck. And I'll give you the 1-7. Adam 4 of Loughborough in 1. Cameron Brody of 2. Sterling. 3, Joe Roebuck. 4 is Dan Wallace of Warrender, second fastest qualifier from this morning. Michael Gunning of Beckenham in 5. Adam Mallett of Swansea in 6. Sean Campsey of Warrender Bath. So we'll see the British record holder go in the next race. In fact, no, he's not there. So after giving him the big build-up, I've just noticed in second semi-final, he's not there. So we'll forget about Michael Rock and we'll look at Daniel Wallace and Joe Roebuck here, shall we?
Joe Roebuck's got a PB of 155.94. His season best is 157.54. So that was slower than what Michael Rock went this morning. So he'll be looking to put out a really strong benchmark now, moving on and getting into one of the fastest lanes in tomorrow night's final. Joe normally tends to go out a conservative over the first 100, so it'll be interesting to see what time he turns at the 100-metre mark.
How's this race unfolding with 100 to go? It is Joe Roebuck who is leading, and leading by about a body length. Cameron Brody's his closest adversary at the turn. Dan Wallace is in third place, Michael Gunning in fourth. Of course, Joe Roebuck has now given up the 400 IM and is concentrating on the 200 fly and the 200 IM.
It's probably two of the hardest events you can do, 400 metres IM and the 200 metres fly. So, you know, if I was him, I'd give him both of them by now. But he's a world-class swimmer in the 200 metres butterfly. He was desperately ill last year going into the London Olympic Games and really did ruin his performance there. So he'll be looking to have a strong 2013 and especially going into the Commonwealth Games next year.
50 to go then, and Joe Roebuck has almost a second lead over Dan Wallace, who's moved into second, Cameron Brody in third. And again, it's now one of those races where it's a man against the clock. At this time, it is Joe Roebuck against the clock. 15 metres to go for him. They're bouncing away to great effect behind him, but they're not making any impact on Joe Roebuck. He's going to come in to finish in 157.64. And he's won that by almost a 2 clear seconds over Daniel Wallace in second place, Michael Gunning in third, and fourth going to Adam Mallett. So once again, Joe Roebuck just going through the motions this morning and doing it for real tonight.
Yep, certainly. As you can see him coming into the third turn, nice and tight, working that underwater phase, going about 10 metres, coming into the finish, head down, right into the wall. You saw there, 157.64. 0.1 of the time that he won Leeds in Leeds International in March. So he's obviously gone back to training, put a big effort of workload in, and now is really reaping the benefits for that.
That's how they finish. Roebuck, Wallace and Gunning, 1, 2, 3.
It's really interesting to see that Michael Rock isn't doing this semi-final, so obviously he put a marker down this morning and wanted everyone else to beat him, but you can't qualify from a heat, so it's interesting to see why he did that.
Maybe he's got an exam this afternoon. I don't know if he's doing law, he's probably doing quite a few exams at the moment, but so no Rocky. That's the man who pulled out. So we have 8 in the second semi-final, though, and these are they. Thomas Bain in 1, Lewis Smith, who goes for Swim Swansea in 2, Matt Johnson and Roberto Pavoni. That should be a good little head-to-head in 3 and 4. And a few others in the outside lanes there from Scotland and from Wales and from Leeds, Muir, Hatfield and Ryan Flanagan.
Watch out for Roberto Pavoni. He trains with Daniel Fogg day in, day out. All the talk before this competition was about Pav and how he was going to swim, and Daniel Fogg has just produced an incredible 400 metres freestyle. So he's in great form. You'd expect the likes of Pav to be in great form as well, so watch out for him.
As I mentioned earlier, Matt Johnson preparing for the European Juniors, which start at the end of next week. But he'd love to get on the senior team for the Worlds in Barcelona. Not the final this time, of course. It's semi-final number 2. Lewis Smith going in 2. Matt Johnson for City of Sheffield, who, of course, is already gone in the 400 free tonight, so he might be a little bit tired after that. Roberto Pavoni in 4 for Loughborough. And Tom Hatfield, of course, was our 2008 Olympian who went in the 400 IM.
Yeah, that's right. Hatfield might just be using this as a swim to get into the meet. A lot of swimmers do that. They always tend to, you know, if they've got the best event coming in later on in the week, they'll enter an event just to kind of blow those cobwebs away, get a feel of the meet and get some racing underway, and that's probably what Thomas Hatfield's going to do. But there's no doubt who's winning the first 75 metres is Pav. He's looking incredibly strong. He's already about 5 metres ahead. This could be a very, very quick time.
Quick time and a bit of procession, maybe, if Matt Johnson can't close him down and Luke Howdle on the other side of him can't close him down. The Nova Centurion swimmer and Bill Furness, the new National Performance Director, will be delighted. That's his former club and probably one of the people he left behind when he took up the reins as the MPD. He'll be delighted to see that because he's going like a train in five, but not as fast as the express that is Roberto Pavoni.
That's right, 6 or 7 metres ahead now. He's going to have a choice when it comes to this third turn. Does he back off and he's back for tomorrow night, or does he put his head down and go to the wall and produce a quality time?
His 150 time is 125.94. Second is Luke Howdle, but yes, as Ross is saying, over two, nearly 2.5 seconds behind in second, and Matt Johnson's got a bit of work to do in third.
Certainly doesn't look like Pav's easing down at all. He's got 15 metres to go. Second place looks like it's going to beat Luke Howdle from Nova. And Matt Johnson, who has done that 400 metres, is trying to close him down as well. So the time is coming into the wall.
Look at this. It's a personal best for Roberto Pavoni, is it not? We don't have a time, but I think it was, as I was watching the clock tick round. We don't yet have a time on the clock, but I think Roberto Pavoni has just done a personal best. It was, well, maybe just outside it. It was very close, but certainly he's won that by a long way. Luke Howdle breaking the two-minute barrier for the very first time in second place. And third place going to Matt Johnson, 2:00.01 for him. Season's best for Matt Johnson. We await Roberto Pavoni's time, though. I think it was 157.16, just outside his best, but well inside his season's best. That is a season's best of about 2.5 seconds for Pav.
Yeah, that's right, 2.5 seconds inside his season best, just a second outside his best time that he produced last year at the Olympic trials to qualify for the team. So he's obviously in form, his squad is on form. Interesting to see how he'll go in the final tomorrow night and into the 400 metres IM later on this week.
There's the finishing order then. Roberto Pavoni and Luke Howdle, Matt Johnson in third, and Ross Muir. So fastest time by quite a way in the end. Time for Joe Robart, 157.64. So about a half a second between him and Roberto Pavoni, winner of the second heat of the men's 200 metres butterfly. And we will see the final of that tomorrow night. It's going to be a really good scrap between Roberto Pavoni and Joe Roebuck in the final.
We now move on to the victory ceremony in men's 400 metres freestyle
butterfly there, and I do not envy any of those swimmers because I do believe that is possibly the hardest race you will swim. Four lengths of butterfly is pretty much as tough as it gets, and somebody won't even be able to agree with me because he's not even a butterfly swimmer, so he wouldn't know. But we do have to fill for Ross because he's running back and forth from the commentary box to the studio throughout the rest of this week, and I think it's going to keep him very fit, actually. But Ross, looking at those 200 butterflies, you know, who stood out to you as someone who's going to go for it in the final?
The two winners of those two semi-finals, Joe Roebuck and Roberto Pavoni, looked a class apart to me. Matt Johnson had already done the 400 metres freestyle early on this evening. He's still putting a very strong time. So he'll be fresher tomorrow night, but I can't see anybody separating Joe Roebuck and Roberto Pavoni tomorrow night.
Because we saw that Michael Rock wasn't there, and this is the guy who's beaten Michael Phelps before. You know, this is the guy who you see in a fly race. Now, do we know where he was, what he was thinking? Because he's not going to be able to qualify now, is he?
No, the Phelps slayers, you know, we used to like to call Michael Rock, producer. Well, he would have been the quickest, fastest through to the final, 157.1 from this morning, and didn't come and do it in the semi-final. Whether he doesn't know what kind of shape he's in, his move club, the year after the Olympics, is probably not, you know, it's not probably that confident enough, and he probably swam that race hoping that he would swim well going into the 100 metres later on in the week.
And then the women's 200 metres butterfly, who really stood out to you there?
And there's only one really, and that's Gemma Lowe. She looked a class apart. Competed the last two Olympic Games. Our number one 200 metres butterfly from last year. Very close to a medal in 2011. Obviously, Ellen Gandy now has moved on to Australia and is competing for Australia now, so it's left a whole void there for her to step into her shoes, and she's doing that very well.
Do we know why she moved over there? She was the one who was favourite to win in London, and then now she's completely off the scene.
Yeah, that's right. Well, she lives and trains in Australia, so and she's always having to come back for the British trials and compete for Britain. I think she was very proud to represent Britain, but because her family were out there and now she's been through school in Australia, she's, you know, seeing an Australian lad, I think now it's time for her to probably move on and really concentrate on becoming an Australian now.
Absolutely, and we are now moving, flying through these semi-finals. We're going back to Bob for the women's 100 metres breaststroke.
And the lineup for the first semi-final of the women's 100 metres breaststroke is as follows. Hayley Monteith, Molly Renshaw, looking for her to do something special here. Rachel Wilson, Stacey Tatton, of course, the brilliant, and I think to be proven very soon to be a very brilliant swimmer, Siobhan Marie O'Connor in lane number five. Here come the eight. And so we'll be looking at, just mark your card, lane two, Molly Renshaw, Stacey Tad in four, and Siobhan Marie O'Connor in lane number five now. Siobhan was 15 years of age when she went to her first World Championships in Shanghai in 2011. She did the Olympics, of course, on the Olympic team in 2012. But so many people are saying so many good things about Siobhan Marie O'Connor, expecting her to be our next female superstar.
Cannot disagree with you there, Bob. She really is a class act. Last year she didn't make the 200 metres IM in London, so she quickly went back to training, trained herself for the 100 metres breaststroke, and the second trials qualified for that. That just shows the remarkable athlete that she is, that she can miss it in one event, go back and train and qualify in another event.
Let's see what Molly Renshaw can do. Of course, another one of our emerging talents who just missed out on making that Olympic team in 2012. But you can see straight away it is Stacey Tad who won't want to relinquish the 100 British title here in lane four. Siobhan Marie O'Connor in lane number five. And it is Stacey Tad who's pushing hard. Now she's been working very hard with her coach Mark Skilling on getting this right. She's really a 200 swimmer at most of the time, but that's not bad for her. It's 68.69, a season's best for Stacey Tad. Siobhan Marie O'Connor in second, 69.26, and third, Rachel Wilson of Derwentside.
It's actually a PB for Stacey Tad as well, just 500 seconds PB, and she was looked incredibly strong down that last 50 metres. Siobhan looked very, very comfortable. Molly Renshaw, another one of the young up-and-coming swimmers, more of a 200 meter breaststroker, coming in fourth place from the DaVinci XL swimming squad.
Really good news for Stacey Tad, because that will surely impact on her 200 later in the week, which is her main event. But in her secondary event, she's got a new personal best, 108.69 for Stacey Tad. Siobhan Marie O'Connor in second, Molly Renshaw in fourth. Might be a little bit disappointed with that, looking at her time. Yeah, she's done 110, 112 before, so she's about 0.3 of a second outside her best.
She had a big heartache last year of going under the qualification time at the wrong time last year and missing out on the Olympic Games. So she's obviously come back strong, but just outside her PB there, she might be working completely towards the 200 and not really concentrating on the 100 metres breaststroke. And in that case, that was a great swim.
Still waiting for this to be classified in terms of getting a final result, because there might be a disqualification here. That's always an agonising thing for a swimmer, isn't it, Ross, where you're sitting there waiting. The results have not been tabulated yet. They've not been confirmed. You think, is it me? What have I done?
You always know when they've not been confirmed that there is 9 times out of 10 a disqualification, but as we can see on the board now, there wasn't a disqualification. The referee's just been a bit slow there.
Well, I can put you in touch with him a bit later on, but Stacey Tad winning that confirmed now, and Siobhan Marie O'Connor in second place. That's how it looks. Stacey Tad, Siobhan Marie O'Connor, and Rachel Wilson, the 1-2-3, and Molly Renshaw in four. On semi-final number two, and this one contains the fastest qualifier, surprise fastest qualifier as well. Georgina Evans in lane number four, and Sophie Allen goes in three. And there's some of the crowd who are here supporting the swimmers. It's a lot of posters up around Sheffield advertising this event, trying to get people to feel the Olympic effect and support the swimmers through 2013 and of course ahead of the World Championships at the end of July. It is warm in here, we can attest to that. It is very warm in here. Georgina Evans, though, I've got to say, was to me one of the surprises of the morning. City of Liverpool, of course, like Michael Rock, with a personal best and faster than Sophie Allen, fastest qualifier.
Yep, came in this morning, did the business, qualified fastest through to the final. George Evans was fifth at the British International, so on the 200 metres, so expect her to come back extremely quick.
So we're looking at lane four, Georgina Evans and Sophie Taylor of Leeds in five and Sophie Allen in three. They were the three grouped as the fastest qualifiers. Now, Georgina Evans this morning for City of Liverpool to the time of 1:08.78. Sophie Allen has a slightly quicker time in terms of her personal best. Maybe she was just holding a little bit back, but Georgina Evans really went strongly this morning. Should she back it up?
Be interesting to see if she does, but it's Catherine Johnson in lane six had a fantastic start. She represented Scotland at the Commonwealth Games in Delhi for the 50 metres breaststroke. Also, Sophie Allen had a really strong start in lane three, and it is Catherine Johnston that's turned first at the 50 metres.
32.36 at the turn. Georgina Evans in second place, third to Sophie Allen, and fourth to Sophie Taylor, and they are absolutely strung out here. You could pretty much put a blanket across 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. They are pretty much in a line. This is going to be a very difficult one, of course. Well, I'm going to wait until they get a bit closer to the wall before I do. It could well be Sophie Allen's getting the touch. She's just got a little bit of momentum, just getting ahead of Georgina Evans, I think. Whoa, she didn't. Yes, she did. By 4/100 of a second, 1:08.57 for Sophie Allen. Not a personal best for her, but for Georgina Evans, second personal best of the day by 17/100 of a second, third to Sophie Taylor.
Georgina Evans should have won that race. As she was coming into the finish, she bent her arms and then pushed them forward, where Sophie Allen, we'll just see this now, Sophie Allen finished with locked arms. Georgina Evans bent her arms and then slapped them forward, as you can see there. That cost her the win. Luckily for her, it was only the semi-final and not the final, because that would have cost her probably a chance of going to the World Championships.
Well, she is just 16 years of age, so she is learning. 16 and a half, to be honest. But Georgina Evans second for Liverpool and first for Sophie Allen, Sophie Taylor in third. And Catherine Johnson, after a great first 50, fell away in the second to finish in fourth place. But the qualifiers will be amongst that group, and they will look forward to the final of the 100 breaststroke tomorrow night. And that could be a very interesting little encounter, because there's a lot of people in there. Siobhan, Marie O'Connor, Stacey Tadd, and of course they won't know a great deal, I think, about Georgina Evans there.
No, they won't. She's only 16. She was born in 1996. I remember 1996. I was at school. But it says where you were, Bob.
I think I was picking my old age pension at that point, Ross. Thank you very much. On to the 100 backstroke and semi-final number one. We have a full contingent here, and we have, of course, the British record holder at both 50 and 100. Liam Tancock going in for Ryan Bennett to his right. Actually, to his left in the backstroke, and Craig McNally going in at lane number five. That's your 1:08.
Liam Tancock's changed coach. Ben Titley moved on to take a position in Canada. And now James Gibson, the former world champion at the 50 metres breaststroke, is now coaching the likes of Liam Tancock and Fran Household. Liam looks in incredibly good shape. I've heard the work he's been doing. He's putting a lot more work in. He's taking a lot more ownership on his own training. So it'll be really, really interesting to see how he goes in this 100 metres. I don't expect him to be 100% in. I think he'll back off towards the end of the race.
So I don't think we'll see a 52.73 in the semi-final, which is his personal best and is the British record. But I think we might see some of the others cracking the whip and trying to get personal best in this race, including the likes of Liam Knight from City of Peterborough, who impressed us in Leeds. He goes in lane number six. Xavier Mohamed now being looked after by Dave Haller in Cardiff. And Ryan Bennett. Now, Ryan Bennett's been there or thereabouts, nearly made the Olympics, nearly makes world championship teams. He'd like not to be the nearly man here.
That's right. It's just unfortunate for him. He's next to a quality swimmer, as in Liam Tancock, won the world championships the last 2 years, last two times running. He'll be going for a hat-trick of wins this year. in Barcelona in a couple of weeks' time. But it is Liam that turns over first in 26.49. And Liam has been working incredibly hard on the last 50 metres of his race, because that's normally where he tends to die off. But it looks like already Liam's just sat back down and is just letting this race pass him by.
What he won't want to be is beaten, though, and he could possibly be beaten by Craig McNally here, because he's easing up. He might even finish in third place here, Liam Tancock. He's finished in second place behind Craig McNally. That is a bit of a surprise. 54.98 the winning time. 55.23 for Liam Tancock in second, and third place going to Ryan Bennett. So just to get clarification, I say the 1-2 I have on the board. Yeah, third place to 55.27 for Ryan Bennett. But Liam Tancock beaten in a domestic event.
He was beaten as well in Leeds in March, but to be honest with you, Liam looked like he was going through the motions there. He still doesn't look like he's out of breath now. He's got plenty more in the tank. But it's a great swim from Craig McNally. 54.98, easily through to the final tomorrow night. Liam, I'd expect him to be around about third or fourth, and it is actually a PB for Craig McNally. His PB previously was 55.22, so he's gone 0.3 quicker there, so an excellent swim from Craig.
Very good stuff from Craig McNally, and that's a little feather in his cap, a little notch on his belt that he has beaten the British record holder. Now, this is intriguing because these two often get paired together, and once again, like they were in the heats this morning, lanes 4 and 5, Chris Walker-Hebben and Marco Lochran going in lanes 4 and 5. But is there somebody who could possibly clear the pitch here? Could it be Joseph Patching in lane 6, European junior champion in the 200 back in 2012? Now, that's Chris Walker-Hebben in lane number 4. But let's have a quick look and see what Joe Patching in 6 is all about. Let's see whether he's readied and prepared. And there he goes into the pool, ready for this. You pointed him out there, Ross. You obviously got some inside word.
Well, we saw him in Leeds in March time, qualifying fastest through to the 200 metres backstroke. So he certainly is more of an endurance backstroker. So it'll be interesting to see when he turns at the 50 metre mark, how quickly he comes back on that second 50. But as it looks like now, it is Chris Walker-Hebben and Marco Lochran going through the first 25, first and second. We don't tend to see much of Marco through the most of the year. He just trained out in America, or he certainly did train out in America, so he doesn't really come back that often. But we are seeing him now go neck and neck with Marco, with Chris Walker-Hebben down at first level.
I'm always amazed how deep Chris Walker-Hebben goes off the start. He disappears. You look across, you see there's 7 swimmers, and you miss one. It's him, because he's gone that deep. But he's leading this race, and with 15 to go, looks like he's going to lead it all the way through. Marco Lochran has no response. Joe Patching at the moment has no response. And Chris Walker-Hebben's been doing a good body of training, so he says on Twitter. And I think he's proving that he's in pretty good shape here. Now, what kind of time could he post? 53.41 is a new personal best for Chris Walker-Hebben, and it's a personal best by 3/4 of a second, and he's done the time for the World Championships.
That's a huge swim from Chris Walker-Hebben, knocking around about 0.8 off his PB. We saw Liam Tancock in the previous semi-final. He will not be happy with the time Chris Walker-Hebben's just posted there. I think Liam last year at the Olympic Games went to 53.2, 53.3 to come around about 6th place. Chris Walker-Hebben's just gone 53.4, which would have got him into the Olympic final last year and was challenging for medals. So that is an incredible swim for a semi-final. He obviously put on Twitter that he was in good shape. He's proved then that he is in completely control of that semi-final, and it is a world championship qualification time.
Well, maybe this is the year that Chris Walker-Hebben does what he always says he can do, and this could be it. 53.41, he won that by over a second in the end. He won it by 1.19 seconds. Jonathan Kerlan in third, Joseph Patching equal third with him on 55.24. Yeah, I didn't see that coming, I've got to admit, but impressive stuff.
When we look at Liam, he is the British number one. His PB is 52.7, so he's only 0.7 away from that mark. So that is, you know, that's certainly going to have giving Liam something to think about when he goes to sleep tonight. That was an incredible swim from Chris Walker Heaven. He looks in great shape. He normally targets the 200 metres backstroke. Maybe he's dropped down to the 100 this year. Maybe the 200 is going to be even better. Who knows? It's going to be very, very interesting to see later on in the week.
On to the lane order for the women's 200 metres backstroke semi-final number one. And Danielle Lowe was the fastest of the swimmers from the heats this morning, going into this semi-final at least. Charlotte McKenzie of the first club in five. Danielle Stirrett of the City of Cardiff will be either side of her. Couple of youngsters. We've always seen Chantelle Austin go earlier. She's going again for Blackpool Aquatics in lane number eight. Ella Balkley, another of the 16-year-olds. And she goes in lane number one. But this should be about Danielle Lowe. Season's best of 2:13.22. Qualifying time of 2:14.51. It's really a chance for all these swimmers here, Ross, to beat their personal best. This is the kind of pool you need to do it in as well, Pontsforge.
Yeah, that's right. It's probably one of the best pools in the world, Pontsforge. I know all the British swimmers love swimming here. They call it the magic waters. So this is the place to do it. And especially when you've got the World Championships in 3 weeks or 3-4 weeks' time. We've got the likes of Gemma Spofforth that's retired last year. Steph Proud's not here. We've got Lizzie Simmons that is in the heat afterwards. So it's exciting to see who's going to take this event forward with Lizzie going into the next 3 years.
So representatives from Birmingham, Loughborough, Cardiff, Bebington SC, and Falkirk and Milton Keynes and Birmingham. So quite a good spread in Blackpool as well, all represented in the first semi-final of the women's 200 metres backstroke, where it goes to form and goes by what we saw this morning. It should be lane number four we're seeing mainly, but at the moment it's not. It is lane number five from the first team up there in Falkirk. Charlotte McKenzie has had a decent start and probably 35. She is leading. She won't be aware, of course, what's happening on either side of the pool to her, but all she needs to do is care about what she's doing, and she will go into the wall behind Rachel Lefley, who just got the touch on that turn. Danielle Lowe in second place and Charlotte McKenzie in third.
Yep, in a minute it is lane two that's out there in front, Rachel Lefley. A little bit of information, she actually goes out with Daniel Fogg, so hopefully she'd be very, very happy with the way Daniel Fogg swam earlier, and now she's leading this semi-final number one by about half a metre ahead of lanes four and five.
As a topic for another night, swimmers in relationships. I think it could be a Channel 5 documentary before too long. Anyway, at the halfway stage, Rachel Lefley leads. Danielle Lowe in second place. Third at the turn is Charlotte McKenzie. Gap between first and second was about 7/10 of a second. And fourth place, need to make up some ground here, Danielle Stirrett. But of course, in the 200 backstroke, as many races like this, it does tend to change on this leg. It's almost this 50 where things start to unfold.
Really important on a 200 metre race that the third leg is your strongest leg, whether that's freestyle, backstroke, butterfly, or certainly on the IM when you get onto that breaststroke leg. It's the third leg that's the most important. You see Rachel Lefley coming up around about 5 metres off the turn, but the swimmer next to her, Danielle Stirrett, taking about 10 metres and Bill eating into her lead. But it is Rachel Lefley with only 25 metres to go out there in front.
Rachel Lefley has this in the bag. It's going to be a big surprise now if anybody can overhaul her, and they're not going to. Rachel Lefley will get this. Second place, though, feral battle between Danielle Lowe and Charlotte McKenzie. Easing up a little bit to Rachel Lefley. She knows she's got this one sorted, and she has in 2:12.29. That's a big new season's best for her. Second place, Charlotte McKenzie came through very strongly at the end to finish 2:13.43, and that will be a new personal best for the first swimmer. And third, Danielle Lowe of Bebington.
Rachel Lefley had an operation earlier this year on her groin, so she's come back very, very strong from that, taking that first semi-final. As you can see, that she's swimming extremely close to the lane rope. I'd advise her to come a little bit closer to the middle of the lane, so she's not giving any of the other swimmers any advantage by riding off her wave. And also, every time you bang into that lane rope, you are slowing yourself down. So she was incredibly close there.
But it's a good result for Rachel Lefley and a personal best for Charlotte McKenzie. So Lefley from McKenzie with Danielle Lowe in third and Daniel Stirrat of City of Cardiff. They are the 1-2-3-4 in the first semi-final of the 200 backstroke. And of course, if you have one semi-final, then you have to have one following pretty soon. They're still waiting to get some of these swimmers out of the pool. It's a tough race there, and some of them have still not got out of the pool yet. You can see them in the bottom of your picture there, still making their way out of the pool as we bring the swimmers in for the second semi-final of the 200 metres backstroke for women. And Lizzie Simmons, a name you will be familiar with in lane five. Lauren Quigley, though, on Stockport Metro, is having an astonishing 2013. Seems to me that every time she goes in the pool, she's improving on her personal best. She's winning a lot of domestic meets this year. And Jessica Fuller loves the City of Manchester. They've got high hopes of her as well.
Yes, yeah, certainly the girls you mentioned are really, really talented individuals. Lizzie will be very, very cautious of Lauren Quigley in lane four. Lizzie's obviously the one to beat. She's represented Great Britain the last two Olympic Games, won numerous medals, European champion from 2010, but she has moved coach. How is that going to affect her this year, moving on into the World Championships?
We will see. Yeah, she's moved from Loughborough down to Bath, as Ross was mentioning, and now training with Dave McNulty. Semi-final number two, Lauren Quigley, though, was the fastest qualifier this morning. I got the impression that Lizzie was taking it relatively easy. Lauren Quigley was giving it quite a bit, and we'll keep an eye on those centre lanes. Five is Lizzie Simmons, four is Lauren Quigley, and three is Jessica Fuller-Love. The race probably will not start to develop or really unfold until we get to the 100 stage, maybe the 150 stage, but certainly going more purposefully, more powerfully in the semi-final than she did in the heat. Lizzie Simmons turns in 30.53, and already she's got a lead of about a couple of tenths of a second.
Yes, she certainly does. Lizzie always tends to go out fast and then tries to hold on. But now moving down to the University of Bath, Dave McNulty is very much about the second half of the race. So she can keep that speed together and then add that fitness and endurance to the second half of the race, she can be a real force. She was had a great swim last year in London, coming fourth, just missing a medal last year. And she was out there the first three lengths, but just died off towards the end of the race. So if she can work on that, she can be a major player in the world team.
Well, I know she still believes she can, her coach believes she can, and she's made the change to try and improve, and she is moving over to that right-hand side of the lane rope as she looks, the left-hand side as we look, but she's not too close to worry about it at this stage. Waiting for Lauren Quigley to make her move. She hasn't made her move yet, but Jessica Fuller-Love is starting to make hers in lane three.
Jessica Fuller-Love is a clear second at the minute, and she is moving up to catch Lizzie going into this final turn. Lauren Quigley is just outside of that, probably about 2 metres behind Lizzie Simmons and a metre behind Jessica Fuller-Love. Lizzie using a good 11 metres off that final turn. This is where the lungs are burning, but it looks like she's incredibly easy and comfortable, just going through the motions, ready for tomorrow night's final.
We all love to see Lizzie in this kind of form, all apart from her opponents, of course. And watching Jessica Fuller-Love just coming closer and closer with every stroke, but she's left it too late to overhaul Lizzie Simmons, who's going to win this by about half a body length in the end of the touch. Wasn't quite as clear cut at the end as it looked with 50 to go. Lizzie Simmons, 2:11.05 is her time, 2:11.59 for Jessica Fuller-Love. Lauren Quigley, I think, will be a little bit disappointed with that. She wasn't as competitive as maybe she ought to have been. 2:12.80 for her, but she'll make it through to the final with that, surely.
Yeah, she'll qualify around about fourth position tomorrow night, Lauren Quigley will. Lizzie Simmons owned that race from the moment she dived in to the moment she touched the wall. 2:11, you know, Lizzie's been a lot quicker than that, but this would be a meet for Lizzie to find out where she is, settle down into the University of Bath, settle down with a new coach, and hopefully if she can produce a world-class time here, that'll give her great confidence going into the next 3 years.
So, Lizzie Simmons is the fastest qualifier and the winner of Semi-final number two, Jessica Fuller over Lauren Quigley. As you can see, the gap in the end was not quite as big as it looked like being at one stage. Lauren Quigley in third, Natasha Houghton in fourth place. There's a 1-2-3-4 from the second semi-final of the women's 200 meters backstroke. Of course, all these semi-finals, the finals will take place in the final session on Thursday night.
I mean, there's so much to take in, and we've already got Ross back here. He's the speediest guy I've seen on this poolside. And to be honest, there was a lot of exciting things going on there, from the 100 metres backstroke, 200 backstroke, 100 breast. Which do you think is going to be the most one to look forward to tomorrow?
The men's 100 metres backstroke. For me, the swimmer of the meet so far is Chris Walker-Hebben, 53.4 in the 100 metres backstroke. That's a quick time. We spoke about it in commentary. That is a world-class time. That was making the finals last year in London. So Liam's got his... Got a big job in his hands tomorrow to retain his title that he's won for probably the last 10 years.
And I think we might have some clips of the racing that we might be able to bit of an analysis on. So it would be great if we could sort of see there was a couple of finishes that actually were a bit dodgy. I know we can't get the clips right now, but Georgina Evans really did lose the race in that final 5 metres and was touched out by Sophie Allen.
Yeah, certainly. Sophie Allen kind of went in with her arms locked out, whereas... the girl in lane 5 came up and then slapped her hands onto the wall. So I think she lost that. Luckily for her that it was only the semi-final, not the final.
Exactly. And we go straight onto the breaststroke. We've already seen the semi-finals tonight, and now we're going into the 50 metres breaststroke. So let's head over to Bob to find out how that final unfolds.
Yeah, it's going to be over in a flash. Well, probably over in about 27 and a half minutes or thereabouts. There is your 1-2-8, Dan Slawinski, Ross Murdoch and Adam Peaty, the ones to watch out for in this final. And of course, Craig Benson as well, and in lane 7. Don't really expect to see him in lane 7, but maybe he's playing possum and going to have something to show us in the final. Final of the men's 50 metres breaststroke. Dan Slawinski, the 100 breaststroke British record holder, looked very good in the semi-finals. How good is he going to look in the final? Well, of course, as usual, lanes 4, 5 and 6 pretty much together, but it is Daniel Slawinski who's going to be pushed all the way, but he's not going to get caught on this kind of form. This is very impressive stuff from Dan Slawinski. If he can keep it going to the wall, Slawinski's going to post a very good time. It is 27.40. That is amazing from Dan Slawinski, considering he hasn't done a lot of work this year, but he's done a lot of work here to get that time. 27.40. Adam Peaty, 27.58. That's another new personal best for him. And third place to Ross Murdoch. Craig Benson, surprisingly, back in sixth place.
That's right. Craig Benson normally is a 100-meter swimmer coming down to the 50, but Daniel, it was all about Daniel Slawinski, a real quality time, 27.4 to win that heat. Also, Adam Peaty from the city of Derby, he backed up his bronze medal from the Leeds International meet here with a silver medal and just missing out on gold by 18/100 of a second.
Well, I know that Mel Marshall will be absolutely delighted with that. 27.58, a big new personal best for Adam Peaty. And the best before from Daniel Slawinski was 27.76, so he's beaten his by 0.36 of a second. Ross Murdoch, 27.67. That may well be a new Scottish record. I think it is. 27.67 is a new Scottish record for the 50, so everybody's happy, aren't they?
Certainly will be. But for me, Adam Peaty's not really been concentrating on the 50 that much. It looks to me like Daniel Slawinski is just solely concentrating on the 50s. He's got the qualification time now for the World Championships. He's not doing the 100 metres, but it looks great that Adam Peaty going into the 100.
Let's hear from Dan Slawinski, and he is with Cassie Patton to tell us about that swim.
I'm on poolside with the British champion for 2013 on the 50 breaststroke, Daniel Slawinski. How does that feel? You had a bad year last year of injury, coming back British champion.
Yeah, it feels amazing. I mean, them 27 seconds just literally got rid of any bad memories I've had from the last 12 months of wasting my life. So it's nice to let them all out, and hopefully from here I can move on to next season and get a full season in and do what I'm capable of.
So you've obviously come over, got over injury, got into a new training routine. Are you racing again this week?
No, I mean, I got back in from Olympic trials in May, so I've been out about 14 months. So I've done 2 months of training. So So, no, I haven't qualified for the Endurance Summit in over 12 months, so that's me done for the week.
Not bad winning this on 2 months of training. So let's have a massive round of applause for our new British champion for 2013.
Good stuff, Dan Sawinski. You know, I've often said that his best swim in this pool was obviously when he broke the British record, and you were in Rome, I was in Rome, everybody else was in Rome. Very few people saw it.
Yeah, and the news filtered through that this lad had broke the British record on 100 metres breaststroke. James Gibson was out there competing at the World Championships for his country, and somebody else has just come along and broke the British record. So it was quite bizarre, really. But it was bizarre last year how he pulled out of the competition in the Olympics. If it was me, I think I would have swam with my arm hanging on by a thread. But he made that decision to pull out of the Olympic Games, and one that, you know, he obviously won't regret because it's his choice. But to compete in the home Olympic Games, we heard about it a lot last year. It's a once in a lifetime. It's more than that. And he chose not to do it, so it's interesting. His shoulder must have been, you know, really, really hurting him, and it must have been a very tough decision to pull out of the Olympic Games.
While I was gabbling away, and while Ross was saying some meaningful things, we did see the 1-8 for the women's 50 metres freestyle final. Now, unless something extraordinary happens, this will be Fran Housall in lane 4 against the clock. Amy Smith will push her, I'm sure. She's our second-ranked British swimmer, and there she is in lane number 5. Fran Housall is the British record holder. There is Sophie Smith, another busy night for her. Hannah Keane of Hastings in 7. Harriet Cooper of City of Leicester. She is turning 16 next month, and she's already swum, of course, as we saw earlier in the session. But this should all be about the national sprint queen of Loughborough, Fran Housall, going in lane number 4. Now, is it going to be something around about 24 and a half? The season's best 24.44. She already did the time in the heats, time in the semi that she needed for the World Championships. This should be even faster still. Fran Housall going in lane number 4. With training partner Amy Smith beside her.
Yeah, that's right. She had a difficult year last year. She had some injuries and she didn't get the results she wanted in 2012. But she's back here now, and a year later, showing her class. She's already a metre ahead. This is going to be a very, very quick time for Fran Housall.
Very quick, very impressive. And so, Fran Housall, 24.54, but not as fast as she has been the time she set. But it's inside the World Championship qualifying time. Actually slower than the time that ranked her third in the world by a tenth of a second. But it's okay, and she'll be happy. Amy Smith in second, Emma Wilkins in third.
Yes, it was 1-3 for Loughborough University, with Fran taking the gold medal. She'll be pleased with that. Her confidence was very shot last year. She didn't get the results she wanted to. So every swim now she gets in and she swims well, it's going to be building that confidence. We need Fran Housall to be confident. We need her to be happy for her to win medals for Great Britain. And you can see that now. She's happy with the programme she's in. She's starting to swim really, really well. And looking forward to the World Championships in Barcelona, we can expect big things from her.
This is what she did, and it means that she has a passage to Barcelona in a few weeks' time. Not that there was ever really any doubt, I suppose. 24.54 for Fran, Amy in second, Emma Wilkins in third. Now, here comes the big question as we await the men's final. Can Benjamin Proud, the 19-year-old from Plymouth Leander in lane 4, get there? We will see that in a few moments' time. Just to tease it for you, Ben Proud of Plymouth going for a sub-22 swim shortly, but let's hear first of all from the winner of the women's 50 metres freestyle. Here's Fran Housall talking with Cassie Patton.
Sorry, I'm here on poolside with Francesca Housall, winner of the 50 freestyle. How was that, Fran?
It was okay. I just came to put my race plan into practice and see how it went, so it was pretty good.
You were underneath that qualifying time. Now, you're normally one of these swimmers that likes to do every event they can. How many more events have you got coming up this week?
I'm not sure what I'm going to do now. Now I've qualified, I can go home.
Well, I wish you all the best, and I'm sure we're going to see you swimming loads of events in the summer. Well done. Absolutely massive round of applause for Francesca Hossel, British champion for 2013.
Well done, Fran. Job very well done by her in the 50 freestyle, and we're hoping that there's better still to come from her when she reaches Barcelona later in the year. So we're looking at lane number four here without too much doubt. Ben Proud, although Adam Brown will have something to say about it, Grant Turner will have something to say about it, James Sisney May will also have something to say about it, but 21.96 is the British record, and Ben Proud was knocking on 22 earlier in the session in the semi-final. Let's see them as they come on to pool deck. How excited will he be? How excited will John Ruddy's coach be right now?
Incredibly excited. This guy's come. He had a good competition in the British Championships, British International in Leeds. Came second to Anthony Irvine, who was an Olympic gold medalist, and now he's taking this field by storm. He's 0.7 quicker than anybody else in this, and he has got an opportunity to knock off the great Mark Foster off the British record rankings.
That record has stood on the books now. I can't read that far away, since 2008, according to our records, 2008. So it's a five-year-old record, almost to the day, actually, 21st of June, almost to the day, 6 years ago. Mark Foster set the British record, 21.96. So we'll be keeping an eye on maybe our new wunderkind, Ben Proud, in four. Adam Brown in five, Grant Turner in six, James Disney May in two. They will all have something to say about this race. It only lasts about 22, 23 seconds. And having a really good start in lane number five is Adam Brown. Adam Brown doesn't want his title taken away from him. It's splash and dash. It's Ben Proud this side. Adam Brown trying to take him all the way to the wall. But it looks like the man from Plymouth, Neander's got it. He has got it. Now, what kind of a time can he do? Can he go sub 22? He can! It's a new British record. And guess what? It is Adam Brown who gets the touch. Unbelievably, on the wall, Adam Brown, 21.92. Welcome back, Adam Brown. Ben Proud, 22.01. Adam Brown, where did you suddenly find that from? That's an amazing swim from Adam Brown. That's a second quicker than he has been all the way through 2013. Mark Foster's British record, going back to 6 years ago, has gone. And Adam Brown, welcome back.
Incredible swim from Adam Brown. It looked like about 5 meters ago that Ben Proud had it, but Adam Brown somehow got those long, dangly arms onto the wall first and went under 22 seconds for the first time. He's knocked about 0.2 off his PB, just under 0.2 off his PB. That's an incredible time. Benjamin Proud, right on his PB from earlier. Can't do much more than that in the final. Brilliant swim.
There you go. Brown, Proud, whether it's Turner, Adam Brown, 21.92, a new British record. Let us hear from him with Cassie Patton.
So I am on poolside with a new British record holder, Adam Brown. Incredible swim. How are you feeling?
Yeah, unbelievable. Came here hoping to go as fast as I could, British record under the qualifying time. And I did it, so I'm really happy.
So what are you going to be doing now, preparation-wise, ready for, hopefully, Barcelona?
Well, we've still got 50 fly and 100 free this week, but then I'll head back to the States and get ready for Barcelona.
Well, it's an incredible swim. I wish you all the best for the rest of your races. Now, everybody, a massive round of applause for our new British record holder, Adam Brown.
That certainly was a splash and dash. Congratulations to Adam Brown. We love to see people going under those big benchmark numbers. And you know, those 50s, they're hard to really hit personal best because there's such a short period of time to really improve yourselves. And all of those 50s, you know, I think majority of people were doing qualification times. And as Ross joins me again from the commentary box, and qualification times all around there, wasn't it?
Yeah, what an incredible swim from Adam Brown, going under 22 seconds for the first time, breaking Mark Foster's six-year-old record. Absolutely fantastic. You know, I said earlier I had a swim of the day. For me, that is definitely the swim of the day so far.
Well, I'm glad you've joined us, because we've had a couple of tweets with your mentioning, actually. And it was from Dawn De Siena, who said she actually really misses not seeing you in the pool. It's great to hear your voice and to see you on the screen, but she does really miss you. You must have a real fan base out there, Ross.
It's very nice. I've got one. Got one out there, so that's really nice comments, and you know, it's just great to be here, great to be watching the future of British swimming coming through, and then obviously the current swimmers. So it's going to be an exciting week, and one I'm very much looking forward to being a part of.
And another tweet, and I think you might know this young lady, Claire Davenport, has said well done to Robbie Renwick and Daniel Fogg. I think she might be your better half, is she?
Yeah, certainly. Yeah, Claire is Claire's sitting at home watching this, so you know, she's very fond of a couple of the swimmers, obviously being on the relay team with Robbie Renwick for the last, you know, probably 5 or 6 years. So yeah, so it's great to see Robbie winning that 400 metres freestyle.
And I think we're going to be seeing the medal ceremonies of the 50 metres breaststroke, and there we are. Great performances by all the lads, but Dan really stuck out there. Where did that come from?
Yeah, Dan, a tough year last year, making a very, very tough call not to go to the Olympic Games. And like you said, that 27 seconds has wiped away all those bad memories. For me, Adam Peaty, he's only a young lad, he's only 18, 19, from City of Derby. He normally swims very well in the 100 metres, so to have that 50 metres under his belt, silver medal, looks great for the future of British breaststrokers.
Does that kind of make it seem like sprinting's easy? Because, you know, you can just get in after 2 months and get in and do that kind of time, or is it all about timing and perfecting that one length?
Certainly on breaststroke, it's very much about timing. You can't rush a breaststroke event, and certainly on the 50 metre, where the natural tendency is to dive in and rush your arms and rush your legs, that will actually make you go a lot slower. So he's an incredibly talented athlete. You know, we saw him last year going under a minute for the 100 metres breaststroke at the Olympic trials, qualifying for the Olympic Games but having to pull out. So he's not a mug, you know, he's a quality athlete, and he showed that after 2 months of training.
And it was a qualification time, is that correct? So
yep.
Him and, is it Adam Peaty, is going to be hopefully on the team for Barcelona?
Well, hopefully we've got certainly is a qualification time for Dan Sawinski. No, this is the first year that Britain have actually been able to qualify on a 50-metre event, other than the 50-metre freestyle. 50-metre breaststroke, backstroke and butterfly are not an Olympic event, so we're not normally selected purely on 50 events. They're normally selected from the 100 metres and let swimmers swim the 50. But this year, they can come in here, do a 50-metre breaststroke and qualify for the World Championships, and that's exactly what Dan Sawinski has done.
And then we have the presentation for the next race, which was the 50 metres freestyle for the women's. And again, there were some great performances, all of them doing the qualification time, but also they can only take the top two. Amy Smith there getting the silver medal. She's always been a real, real strong member on the team, hasn't she?
Yeah, such a lovely character as well, such a bubbly character. You can see there, she's smiling away. She'd love to stand on that number one podium, but unfortunately for Amy, she's surrounded by great company with Fran Housel, though, who is one of the best sprinters in the world. Difficult year last year again, a bit like Dan Sawinski. She got injured, but she swam in London, didn't get the results she wanted to, so she wants to put these memories behind her and crack on now for the World Championships, going into the Commonwealth Games and into Rio in 3 years' time.
And how does she fare against the rest of the world? Is she a contender for the medals?
Certainly. She went into the Olympics last year, ranked in the top three. Like I say, she got injured and missed a big block of training and wasn't able to do what she wanted to do. She still was, you know, fourth, fifth and sixth into the finals at the Olympic Games, so she's a quality swimmer. Hopefully once she gets a full block of training behind her, she gets her shoulder in order and gets a big bit of endurance work behind her, she can be back up there fighting against not just the medals, but for gold medals for Great Britain.
And also with the fast freestylers have got a chance of maybe getting into the relay team as well, so it's not all over just because they haven't done the qualification time. If they're in that top four position, particularly in the 100 freestyle, they've got a real chance.
Yeah, certainly in the 100 metre freestyle, you know, obviously you can take two for the individual if they've got the qualification time, but also you can take the top four for the relay, and that's what a lot of swimmers will do. If they can't topple the likes of Amy Smith and Francesca House on the 100 metre freestyle, they'll be targeting spots on the relay, because if we've seen already Fran's in incredible form. Her best event is 100, so if we can get a great Francesca Housel raring to go on 100 metres freestyle, we've got a good relay team.
Well, we hope that she'll go for it later on in the week then, won't we? But now we have, in the presentation, we have the men's 50 metres freestyle and the medal ceremony coming up here. And you know, these are the fastest men in water out there in Britain. These are the ones that you don't want to hit in the middle of the length, because who knows, they'll probably take you down. But it was Adam Brown that took the top spot, wasn't it?
Yeah, the camera angle doesn't really show how tall these guys are. They're tall, they're lean, they're mean. All the talk beforehand was about Ben Proud. He still is a brilliant talent coming through for British swimming. And if it wasn't for him, I don't think Adam Brown would have done that time. He is the new British record holder. We've not had a British record for many, many years. So he's become the first British record holder for a long time. So congratulations, Adam. That is a brilliant time.
How do you think Mark Foster will feel? You know, he's held that for
old.
Ages.
I think he'll feel very, very old. He's been the number one sprinter, Mark Foster, for the last probably 25 years. Apart from a short period where Simon Burnett took his British record off him, he regained it towards the end of his career, but now he's lost it. Mark Foster has never, ever retired. So who knows, at the age of 40, whatever, he might be making a comeback.
Absolutely. And the next race we have coming up here is the multi-classification races. So we've already had the 100 freestyle earlier on this evening, and now we've got the 50 metres backstroke and the 100 metres backstroke coming up. Now this next race is probably not the best for viewers, because there is only one entry into this race. Now the 50 metres backstroke is only allowed for classifications S5 and below, and we have the very, very responsible and very grown up Andrew Mullen, who I think he can take on that task very well. But actually, he's got quite a tough task. He's out there on his own, and he will only win the gold medal if he actually breaks his own British record and personal best. Now, that is quite a tough ask, really, and to be honest, when you're out there on your own, I wouldn't want to be there. But this lad, he's only just broken the British record at our trials that we had back in April for the World Championships qualifications in Canada. So he's on form, and I think he'll really, really eat it up. And then later on, we'll have the 100 metres backstroke, where we'll see a few more competitors in those races, and I can guarantee they will be a little bit more competitive. So if it's not too long now until that race comes up, so I think we can hand back over to Bob, who will be introducing Andrew Mullen onto the poolside.
I will be doing that, Kate, and this is intriguing. It could be enthralling, it could be nerve-wracking, because it is one man against the clock, only one man on the graphic, getting a bit lost amongst all those lines. Andrew Mullen in lane number 4 in the S5 category. The time that Kate referred to, the British record, is 39.30. He is the British record holder, getting some tunes, which I know, because he told me yesterday, is hip-hop and rap and sometimes classical. So what did he go with this time? Did he go with classical to soothe the nerves, or did he go with some hip-hop and rap to get him motivated for this? 39.30. He has got to better that. If he equals it, I'm not quite sure what happens, but if he betters it, he gets his medal. If he doesn't, he doesn't. It's him against the clock. 41.56 this morning, so he's got to find a couple of seconds from someone, which is a lot in a 50. But his British record, and of course season's best as it was set this year, is 39.30. It's almost a bit of a deathly hush here as people are watching Andrew break the surface at 15. There's a few more people now starting to applaud and get involved, because it is him against the clock. He will not have any idea. The crowd won't have any idea. Of course, this will be translated into points as well for him. But the most important thing here for him, in terms of getting that medal, because he's on his own, is the time that he sets. 39.30 is his British record. We'll keep an eye on the clock. 37, 38, 39. It's not going to be today for Andrew Mullen. He's just broken the 40 barrier. 40.78. So considerably quicker than he went this morning, but not quick enough to beat or equal his British record. So he's had a swim. But sadly, from this point of view, there is nothing on the end of it. No medal, no going up on the podium. Just another decent time for him, 40.78, which translates to 632 points for Andrew Mullen. And here comes the time, just confirmation for you. Andrew Mullen, 632 points in the S5 category, and 40.78. It's about 3/4 of a second quicker than he went in the morning. Next event will be the women's multi-disability 100 metres backstroke final. And again, for late tuners on, let me just tell you that we have a range of different categories in here. So once again, it'll be a case of looking to see who does what. Now, in this one, we will have Jessica Jane Applegate, who Ross, I think Ross has got his breath back, will attest to the fact that every time, pretty much, we see Jessica Jane in the pool, she breaks a record. She's that kind of animal. She doesn't turn a hole back. She goes in there, and we are going to hear, actually, before we go to that, we are going to hear from Andrew Mullen, and he is going to tell us about his 50 metres backstroke with Cassie Patton.
I'm on pool side with Andrew Mullen. How did that go in that 50? How are you feeling?
I'm pretty pleased with that time. At this point in the season, I've not done too much speed work. I'm on rest and I'm on tapered, so to come and execute a race plan and go a good time, I'm overall pretty pleased with that.
Well, it's always hard to kind of be out here by yourself. How are you going to kind of work over for the next 6 months?
I just try and focus on my own race. I can't control what anyone else does, so as long as I'm racing well, I don't care who I'm racing against.
Well, you got faster this evening than he was this morning, so let's have a massive round of applause for Andrew.
It's a tough race for Andrew there. You know, who would want to be out in that middle of the big pool on their own? But he really did seem to hold it together, and I think we'll look forward to see how he gets on later on in the year at the World Championships, where he'll be probably going to hopefully go to win a medal, because he only just missed out in London. He got fourth in London, so he should take some confidence from that and really get to grips with it when he gets to Canada. Now, let's get back to your tweets. Remember, you can tweet us at BGSC13, and we will read them out. We already have. And the Twitter feed is going a little bit wild over the fact that Adam Brown has broken Mark Foster's British record, and you know, these things, that they are a big deal when they've been held for a long time, so it's great to see people really signing in. Also, we've had Jilly Solway write into us saying she's very proud of Rachel Solway for a new lifetime best in the 100 meters breaststroke. I'm assuming that's her daughter, and there's lots of proud parents here. But I think one tweet I really need to highlight is from Michael Pugh, who says that Matthew Johnson, who's done a back-to-back swim of 400 freestyle and the 200 meters fly back-to-back in one session. Now, that is something I could even dream of doing, and I'm sure most swimmers would be too scared to do so. So fair play to Matthew Johnson for getting through that. And it does say hashtag team steel, which I think is all to do with the city of Sheffield. So they're really pushing their swimmers forward and obviously enjoying swimming in their training pool as well as racing in it. There must be some sort of advantage around that. But as Bob Ballard mentioned, we now have the women's 100 metres backstroke coming up. We've got lots to look out for in this with regards to potential swimmers who could win medals at World Championships later on in the year. So if we hand back to Bob, I think the swimmers will be coming out and we will see what results they can bring us.
They are on their way out now, Kate, for the women's 100 metres backstroke final multi-disability. And there's lots of our biggest names in this race. You can see Amy Marin in there, Jessica Jane Applegate, I mentioned Stephanie Millward, Hannah Russell, and Nairi Kindred, all in this race. Now, Jessica Jane Applegate, what can you do this time in lane number three? The S14 swimmer doesn't actually hold the British record, amazingly, in this. Its personal best is 109.35. The British record is 108.81. But I almost kind of expect her every time, Ross, as we were saying in Leeds, every time she goes in, you kind of expect that she's going to break her record.
You're almost disappointed when she doesn't go on, when she goes under 1,000 points, which is 900 points is an incredible score. And it's like Jessica Jane gets in, and you almost went, oh, she only got 999 points. Every time she gets in, she was 1,000 points, 1,000 points, and she's knocking on the door for that British record. And like we've mentioned with the disability athletes, this is not their main competition. But neither was Leeds, and she was firing all cylinders. So hopefully, with a bit more training under her belt, she can go for that British record tonight.
Sounded very confident when I spoke to her yesterday. 108.81 is the British record in the S14 category, which is hers, by the way. We have a wide range, S6, S10, S12, S9, and S14. As I mentioned, Jessica Jane will be going head-to-head with Natalie Massey in that category, S14, and Katie Nesbitt in lane 8. So there are three S14s. one of the stars of the Paralympics. Not in this event, there was a 200 freestyle in which she did it. Fourth place in the 100 backstroke in London, just missing out on a medal in this event, but she has improved, as we've seen, in leaps and bounds. And once again, I know that we'll get blizzard people saying, yes, I know this already. It is not necessarily the winner who will win it, because it'll be converted to points relative to their category, their disability, and that will be converted up on the scoreboard. But we will be looking to see how Hannah Russell, the British record holder, goes. She's an S12 in lane number five. Amy Marin, who we've mentioned a lot when we did the disability swimming here a few weeks ago, in lane number two. And as far as Hannah Russell is concerned, she's already won race today, and she might be on her way to number two.
Yep, turning first, 33.99 at the first 50 metres, closely followed by Stephanie Millwood, only 0.2 slower, 34.20. Closely followed by Jessica Jane Applegate, only 3 100s behind. So the first three are in a line as we come into the last 15 metres.
And again, we'll have to wait for the board to convert things for us, but Jessica Jane may win this and get the points. Maybe the second time we've seen that happen today. Jessica Jane Applegate comes in to finish with only 893 points, because Stephanie Millward's got 958. It looks like the best for Stephanie Millward in lane four. Lane four, Stephanie Millward in 9.58. Looks like she's won it. Hannah Russell, ninth. They're still waiting for Nairi Kindred to finish with 8.72. So it is Stephanie Millward who finishes with the most points. Hannah Russell in second. And third place going to Jessica Jane Applegate, 109.74, just outside her personal best.
Yeah, you're right. And I think we can see here that this is not the main competition. The World Championships in Montreal are the main competition for the disability athletes. And this is a training exercise. This is just fine-tuning those things they've been working on for the last 6 months, trying to get themselves in the best possible shape, firing all cylinders when they go out to the World Championships in Canada later on in the year.
Stephanie Ward has been in the 105 range, still pretty close to her season's best, 110.29 for her. Hannah Russell in second, and Jessica Jane Applegate getting third place because of her points of 8.93. Last event of the afternoon we'll be seeing very shortly. I think we might possibly be hearing a word or two from the winner of the last race. Just to flag up for you, they're coming shortly, will be our last race of the afternoon. There will be a swim-off coming. I'm not sure, it must be an able-bodied one. Women's 200 backstroke reserve, so we will bring that to you before we close. 100 backstroke, but let's hear from the winner of the women's 100 meters backstroke final. Stephanie Millward's downstairs speaking with Cassie.
So Stephanie, gold here in the 100 backstroke. How are you feeling? You're looking very smiley. How are you feeling?
Oh, that was a wonderful swim. I haven't swum that well for a little while and I'm quite impressed.
It's great to see a swimmer come out and be as happy as you are with your swim. So what is your plans for the next couple of months?
Lots of training. Just keep training and then hopefully go to Canada all confident and ready to do some winning.
Well, I know I'm going to be wishing you the best of luck, and so is everybody here. Let's have a huge round of applause for Stephanie, our gold medalist at the British Championships 2013.
Well done, Stephanie Millward. She's always got a big smile on her face, and she's always a great character to have on the team. She actually came very close to the European record, so bravo to her, because she's a lot older than a lot of the people on the team. And she's only just got married, so she's had an awful lot on her plate recently. But you know what? The next race is probably one of the most exciting ones of the evening. We've already had a world record broken by Jonathan Fox, who won the gold medal in this event at the 100 metres backstroke in London 2012. And this guy, he is fearless. He's going to go out there hard. He's going to make sure that he's going to try and better that swim, because he's a very competitive guy. We've seen him do very well in the 100 metres freestyle earlier on today. And that world record really is something that he's going to want to take further and further again. He's in the outside lane, so really do look out for him maybe not being the first to touch the wall, but he'll be the one in the outside lane, maybe one of the last to finish. So this is something really exciting for you viewers to watch, and hopefully understand the British disability points, as He may be one of the last to finish, but he could be the one getting the most points. Also within that field, we've got a number of British athletes in there that we want to look out for, and I think it's going to be a huge, huge support towards how great British swimming is doing at the moment when it comes to disability swimming. So I'm going to hand you back to Bob Ballard, who is going to take you through the finalists for this particular race.
Let's have a look at what is 0-9 in terms of this race. We have 10 finalists: Sean Fraser, Andrew Gould, Morgan Peters, Aaron Moores, Jack Thomas, Ben Proctor, James Crisp, Jonathan Fox, the new world record holder. 8 is Jack Bridge, and 9 is Michael Jones. I'm hoping that's right, because I have a completely different lane order for this final. Jonathan Fox going in lane number 7, and that new world record set this morning of 109.52.
Michael Jones.
And again, you always look down these lists, Ross, is almost like the who's who of British Paralympic swimming here.
I was just thinking exactly the same. How many years we've been seeing James Crisp repeatedly do it, not only at this stage, but at the international stage. He's been around since 2000, 2004. They've really been along on the scene for the last 10 years, and it is now in lane number 6, fighting for another medal here in Sheffield.
Jonathan Fox is the man to watch out for. He is in lane number 7, going in the S7 category. He is the only S7 in this race. Looks like we don't have Ryan Nichols of the London Borough of Redbridge going to start. Everybody else, no, there isn't. There's not a lane 8 either, so Craig Harris has pulled out. So we're actually back down to the normally prescribed 8. But likelihood here, like this morning, Jonathan Fox will not be the first to finish. He certainly won't be the first to finish. But that's not important. We'll convert his time to points. And if he's over 1,000, or indeed if he's gone over 109.52, we'll know exactly where he stands in terms of that world record.
Incredible swim this morning from Jonathan Fox. To break a world record in a heat, or to break a world record at any time, is a fantastic achievement. But to do it in a heat is absolutely brilliant. He'll be looking to go that little bit quicker so he can break it again tonight. He's firing heading into the World Championships in Montreal.
Visibly and physically, it looks like Jack Thomas, one of the S14s, one of the intellectually disabled, will finish first. Thomas and Aaron Moores in the same category will be 1 and 2, and they'll get 889.872. Now, Jonathan Fox, what are you going to do? 1,002, not as quick though as he went this morning. Lane number 7, Jonathan Fox has gone over the 1,000 barrier once again. It is not quite as quick as this morning though. It is actually 0.3 seconds slower than he went this morning, but nonetheless, he's won that quite convincingly. Second place going to Jack Thomas, and third to Aaron Moores. Yep, that's now confirmed for another 1,000. And when you see that, you know it's something special.
He's certainly doing, like you said, it's only 0.3 off the world record. Incredible swimming. He won that event about 120 points. You can see them now all going into the turn together, 4 or 5 of them in a line. But of course, they're all different classifications, so you don't know who's quite won it until you actually see the points at the end. Heading into the finish, that's it. On the side. On your side, but also on your back, if that makes any sense, but really diving towards the wall to try and make yourself the most streamlined possible to get yourself on the wall as quick as possible.
So, the results are now official. 1,002 points to Jonathan Fox, Jack Thomas in second, Aaron Moores in third, and James Crisp just missing out on the medal this time in fourth, with Ben Proctor in fifth. And that wraps up the entertainment in the pool. We have had quite a sensational afternoon. We've had British records, we've had world records this morning. Day one here in Sheffield has been very busy. We, of course, have the reserve race to come. But we are going to hear from Jonathan Fox all about that world record that he set this morning, not in the evening session, but in the heats. Here's Jonathan Fox with Cassie Fan talking about the 100 backstroke.
So I'm on poolside with world record holder from this morning, Jonathan Fox. First of all, let me say massive congratulations for that world record this morning. How was that swim this evening?
It's a bit slower than this morning, but I gave it hell, and it wasn't fast enough. But before this event, it would have been a world record if I didn't do it in the heat, so I'm pretty happy with that.
So So if you didn't PB this morning and break the world record, that would have been a world record. So that's a massive double well done. So what are you going to be planning for the next couple of months?
Concentrate on worlds 6 weeks' time, really. Just try and do a little bit to the jigsaw to make one big picture at the end. I'm just going to try everything I can to get that gold in Canada.
You're in great shape, swimming well. I wish you all the best. So does everybody here. Let's have a huge round of applause for our gold medalist, Jonathan Fox.
Jonathan Fox there, actually been quite chatty for a change. He's usually a bit of a quiet character, but he really is coming out of his shell and he's getting used to all this media attention that he's receiving because he's just on his way up and I think he's going to do a great job at the World Championships. So that is all our finals and semi-finals wrapped up for tonight, and we've had lots of exciting things take place. We've had plenty of athletes making the qualification time, and we have Ross back in the studio with us now. I think that's going to be your last run.
The last run of the night.
But just before I come to you, we have to remember there is going to be a swim-off, so we will be getting back with the swim-off as quickly as possible once we know it is out there. But just, Ross, before a swim-off, can you imagine having to do a swim-off yourself? Like, have you ever done one?
I've never actually done one, to be honest with you. But this is a swim-off for the first reserve. So if anyone pulls out of the final, one of these, whoever wins this swim-off will go into the final. So, you know, at the minute, they're probably thinking it doesn't really mean anything, but it really is important in case somebody gets injured or ill or actually just doesn't fancy it and pulls out.
Well, I think Bob is on the commentary studio ready to see this swim-off take place. Let's see how they get on.
Yep. And the two swimmers involved will be in lanes 4 and 5. Molly Renshaw probably thought she might be in the final as a right. She's going to have to hope that somebody pulls out for tomorrow. And Katie Armitage is going in lane number 5. Now, what always happens, or always seems to happen when you have a swim-off, is the swimmers go faster in the swim-off than they did in the semi-final. That nearly always happens. I'm not going to embarrass the two swimmers in the pool looking back on their times from the semi-final. But Molly Renshaw will have a little point to prove here, because I think that she'll think that she should be in the final. And she is in the black cap, closest to the camera. In the pink cap is Katie Armitage. So Molly Renshaw. Well, on the turn, she's got about half a body length advantage. Of course, it can change quite a bit over the last 35, and they were absolutely level on time, so we know they are pretty much in the same kind of form. But Molly Renshaw will do a time, I'm sure, here that will get her into the final, and she will be kicking herself all the way through the evening. She's got this race nailed now. She's seen off the challenge of Katie Armitage. She's going to win this relatively comfortably in terms of distance, and I'm sure the time will reflect that as well. Can she do a quicker time than she did in the heats or the semis? It is 1:10.83, so she's won that by a full second. And then you kind of wonder, well, why didn't you do it earlier on, Molly, to be honest? But 1:10.83 is her winning time. Katie Armitage finishing in the 1:11.80. So if there is a withdrawal from the final of the women's 100 metres breaststroke tomorrow, then it will be Molly Renshaw who will be going through. Here's confirmation that ninth in order now will be Molly Renshaw, 1:10.83, beating the time of Katie Armitage in the swim-off for the 100 breaststroke for women.
Well done to Molly Renshaw. I've actually done a swim-off myself and I didn't win it, so I say well done to her because it's a horrible thing to have to do, and she'll be making that 100 metres breaststroke final tomorrow. Now we have the medal ceremonies coming up for the multi-classification races very soon, and we will be talking about the winners of those particular races. But I have Ross back with me, and you've had a busy evening and you must be absolutely exhausted. We'll talk about the qualifications and who's qualified later on, but how have you enjoyed this evening from a different point of view?
It's been absolutely brilliant to be on this side of the fence. We spoke about it earlier, how is it going to be, but this has been brilliant. And some of the swims tonight have been very, very impressive. We're only 4 weeks away from the World Championships. You know, certainly the likes of Robbie Rennick, not fully rested at this meet. So, you know, he's halfway house, we used to call it, where you've had a little bit of rest, you sharpen up, but you're not fully firing all cylinders. And to do a time like that is very, very impressive. So look out for him in the summer. He's very, very ambitious. So he'll be setting his targets extremely high. Daniel Fogg, 400 metres, 1500 metres coming up later in the week. That's going to be brilliant as well.
And how have you found actually commentating on the multi-classification events? Because that's quite a task, isn't it? Understanding who's winning, who's losing. But do you think it is understandable? Can the public get on board with it?
It certainly can. And it, to be honest with you, it's so exciting because you obviously see who touches first, but actually your eyes are fixed on the scoreboard to see how many points they get. And as soon as somebody else comes with a little bit more points, you know, you're looking at them. It's absolutely fantastic to be watching it and to be involved in it.
And we have the medal ceremonies just here. You've just seen Jessica Jane Applegate receive her bronze medal. She's probably not used to being on that bronze medal podium. She wants to be on the top, but with these British disability points, it's all about who is closest to their world record. Hannah Russell will be there. She's very pleased with that. Second time on the podium tonight. So I think she should be over the moon with that result. And then Stephanie Millward taking the top spot. She's always got a massive smile on her face and really, really pleased to see that she's back on form because she's really struggled to get close to her personal best. Her type of disability means that it's hard for her to repeat performances over and over again. But I think that getting close to that European record is going to give her a lot of confidence in knowing that she can go on and become potentially a medalist at the World Championships in Canada in just, I think it's 5 weeks' time, so it's not too long now. And we're actually very lucky because I've actually changed my pundit now. We've had a bit of a swap and I've got Sasha Kindred in with me. And we've just seen the medal ceremony for the 100 metres backstroke. And it's great to see those girls doing so well.
Yeah, you know, they're strong performers. You know, Steph Millward was just off a European record there and she's going to be fighting for the medals in Canada. And with the other girls on the podium, Jessica Jane, you know, she performed really well in London and they're going to be really strong in Canada, so I'm looking forward to racing.
And it's quite nice to have you alongside me. Now, I think you and Ross have got quite a similar resemblance. It's almost like I've got the same person in with me. But actually, I need to build up Sasha a little bit more because you've competed at 5 Paralympic Games. You competed in London. Maybe you didn't get that gold that you wanted in London, but you had a cracking Games, didn't you?
I've had a great career so far, you know, and I did compete well in London. You know, yeah, it would have been nice to get the gold, but I broke her personal best, so I went under the world record to win the silver. Couldn't control what the Chinese swimmer did, and you know, I'm very happy with that medal, and you know, I'm just proud to be part of this great team.
And you've already swam earlier on this today. You got a bronze medal in the 100 metres freestyle, so that was a bit of a shock for you.
Yeah, freestyle, I don't really do that. So I was sort of putting my point in the water there, and I broke the British record in my classification. So I did a good swim, and it's good for my medley, you know, the last leg of that is freestyle. So we try and work on a bit of individual events, and I swam quite quick.
That must suggest to you that training's going really, really well at the moment.
Yeah, it is. You know, I'm training really hard. There's only 5 weeks to go to the World Champs and everyone's in solid training. You know, they haven't tapered or rested for this meet, so to do good times off that is a positive thing and it's all looking really positive for the future.
And we have the medalist coming up here for the men's 100 metres backstroke. And that, you know, it's quite a good range of abilities here. We've got the likes of Aaron Moore, who was on the London team, but maybe he's trying to find his feet again. Bronze medal from Trowbridge, so he actually doesn't train too far away from my train, so lovely guy. And then the S14s really do dominate in the backstroke events, just because they only have a limited amount of events that they can compete in at the Worlds, is that right?
Yeah, there is a backstroke's one of them, and there's two of them on the podium here. You know, Aaron Moore's got silver in this event in London. Jack Thomas has, you know, just picked into the post, got a bit of a better medal. But John Fox on top of the podium again, he's awesome. No world record this morning in the heats. And
you were just saying you're not rested, so surely a world record is out of the question at this time of year.
It should be, but it shows, you know, the training's going well and we're all in good form and good shape, and I'm sure he'll go quicker at the Worlds.
Should we worry that he might have peaked too soon?
No, not at all. John Fox is an animal in training. He trains really hard and he always steps up for the big occasion. He's been on the team for a few years now. He's stepped up in London and I'm sure he'll step up in Montreal again.
He is a bit of a monster when it comes to being in that water. Many times I've watched him race and thought, he's gone out too hard. And you being so experienced, have you ever thought, how is he doing that? How is he managing to hold on that stroke rate for so long?
Yeah, you know, when you're swimming 100 metres, you know, the first 50, you're trying to focus on your stroke length and keep it nice and long so you've got something for the second length. And he always looked like he's working too hard, but he can do it for 100 metres. So good on him. I wish I could do it for 100 metres that hard.
I know, because you're one of the veterans on the team now, and was there a question of whether you were going to retire after London?
Veteran? You're saying I'm old?
Well, I'm afraid, Sasha, you've been on it for longer than I went. I was on for 10 years, and you were on it way before I was, and I think I'm off it again, so you're still standing.
I'm still going, going strong. I broke my PB in London, world record, so... as long as I'm improving and getting quicker, I love my sport, still enjoying it, so I'll continue and hopefully I can get quicker again in Montreal.
And just to finish on Montreal, you've qualified in the 200 metres individual medley and the 100 metres breaststroke.
Yeah.
How are you feeling for that? We said you're getting old. You still feel like you can go out there and win the medals?
I still think so. I'm still doing good training and still improving. I showed today with 100 freestyle, did a PB. So I'm going to be strong in those events. The medley is the one I'm focusing on. And I'll be up there with the younger guys and showing them how I can still continue and hopefully be on the podium.
Thank you very much, Sasha, for joining us. We know how important it is for you athletes to go and get your rest. And we really do appreciate the athletes coming to talk to us, because this competition, it's a long meet. It's over 5 days. This heat is really, really hot. And for them to be able to come and talk to us and really show the public that they are loving their support and really need them to follow them as swimmers as it goes into the World Championships. And now I've had a bit of a switch. And to be honest, I think it's just like twins switching over, because I've got Ross back with me now in a white shirt as well. So very similar looking. And we're going to talk more about the qualification times, who's done those qualification times. We've had a number of finals tonight. First person to do the qualification time was Robbie Renwick in the 400 freestyle, as well as Daniel Fogg. Now, we're not sure if Daniel Fogg's actually going to focus on the 400, but Robbie, great swim.
Yeah, great swim for Robbie. He alluded to it earlier. We spoke about him not being fully rested. That could be probably a couple of seconds that he's probably got to gain. And when you start coming down a couple of seconds on the 147 that he did, you're starting to get into the British record territory. He's only 1.5 seconds away, so that'll be a target of his going into the World Championships to try and break that British record.
And Daniel Fogg, now what process is he going to go through to consider whether he wants to be considered for the 400 freestyle? Because it's quite a different event to the open water.
I have no idea, because he's obviously qualified for the 10K, which is the week before the actual pool swim. So he's going to swim the 10K, he's going to hopefully win the medal, and he's going to win the World Championships, and then he's going to be like, right, I can't relax, I've got the pool. His second main event is the 1500, which comes at the end of the week. So he's got that to contend with at the end of the week. And then he's got a 400 metre freestyle at the beginning of the week. So it's going to be a tough programme. He's not going to have much rest in between. But if he does choose to do the 400, that would be great. A swim that he can get in, get all the rubbish out of his body from the 10K, and use that swim to get kind of pool focused for his 1500 later on in the week.
And we switch from Dan Fogg, who's the master of the distance swimming, to Adam Brown, who qualified in the 50 freestyle. There's been massive attention to this on Twitter, breaking that British record that Mark Foster held. It's great to have some fast and speedy swimmers taking on the sprints at Worlds.
Yeah, it is. Event one was obviously Robbie getting the qualification with Dan Fogg. That was my swim of the day for a long time. And then Chris Walker-Hebbin came, and then Adam Brown, breaking a British record, going under 22 seconds for the first time. He's only the second man to go under 22 seconds in Britain. He is now the British record holder, taking Mark Foster's mantle away from him. He's not going to be happy about that, so maybe Mark's going to be pulling on his trunks as we speak to try and get that record back.
And also, we had Daniel Slinsky, we had Adam Peaty, we've got Fran Housel, Amy Smith, all doing the qualification time. But just because they've done the qualification time, we seem to have hit a bit of darkness at the moment. This is a bit romantic, Ross. Can you sort of see the shadows? We will carry on, because this is just the dramas. This proves that we are live on stream. So, the pool has decided to close without us. But just touch on the fact that we've got these sprinters in, and they're going to... they've done the qualification time, but it doesn't mean they've actually qualified.
Yeah, that's right. They can guarantee 30 swimmers on the team, which will be announced on Monday. So if we get 45 swimmers that qualify, they're going to have to do it on the highest ranked swimmers. So it's great that they've got the qualification times. It will make them hungry, but who knows who's actually going to make the qualification cut on Monday.
Well, thank you very much for joining us today, Ross. I know you've had a very tiring day of running back and forth, but you've done a fabulous job
thank
of taking it
much.
All on board. And we've got a number of events coming up in tomorrow's finals in day two. And I will just give you a quick list just to give you a flavour of what's coming up. We've got the 800 freestyle, the 200 fly, the men's 100 metres backstroke, women's 200 metres backstroke final. We've seen the semi-finals already today. We've got the 100 metres breaststroke, we've got the 400 metres individual medley final, as well as the multi-classification 400 freestyle, 200 freestyle and the 100 metres fly. My gosh, that was such a lot of racing. I don't think we're going to have to cope with it all tomorrow, but I'm sure that you will be with us to join in and follow all the action from the British Gas Swimming Championships. You can also see all the individual finals on swimming.tv, so if you've missed anything, you can also catch up. But that's all from us tonight in the lovely twilight of Ponds Forge. I hope you've enjoyed watching us today, and we've had a great time, and we hope you join us tomorrow, 5:30. Goodbye.